call our meeting to order. In accordance with the open meeting law, the board states for the record that this meeting is being recorded by NORCAM and may be recorded by other local media. Please rise for the pledge. I
pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
I'd like to welcome our guests this evening and those watching on cable. And the first department on our agenda for budget review, I believe, is libraries.
Yes.
Sharon?
I should have checked to see if this is on.
It's on.
Everyone can hear me? Oh, sorry. Good evening, everyone. We appreciate the opportunity to present the library budget this evening. Very thrilled with all the support that we have here. We have trustees here, we have friends here as well, and staff. Youth, Danielle Masterson from Youth Services, and Dan Tremblay, we have already met him, he's our assistant director, so he's here tonight as well. So appreciate the support that we always get at the library. As I was saying, we appreciate the opportunity to present this budget tonight. We have worked very hard to meet the needs and the wants of the community while also trying to maximize every budget dollar. For FY 2018, the request is $540,763. The municipal appropriation requirement this year is $511,486. So as you see with our budget request, we do satisfy the MAR this year. So hanging with A-listers, we have been having a really great year, bringing in some really big name authors, or as we like to call them, A-listers. Our programs, our adult programs, have become really popular. When it was FY14, we averaged about 13 people per program, and now we are averaging about 53 people per program. However, that number seems to keep growing and growing and growing. Ellen Hildebrand, we had over 100 people. We had to actually have a waiting list. We actually had to have staff at the door making sure people had signed up. Dave Wedge, we had over 80 people as well. And Bob Ryan, a very popular sports writer from the Boston Globe, and he has a show on ESPN. The thing that was exciting for us there is that it was 90% men. So we're really trying to reach different demographics, find out what people want and bring those programs in. And what's happening is the more we bring in these great authors, other authors hear about our series and want to be a part of it. So it's actually kind of nice. So collection management. We have restructured our ordering process with how we order books. It used to be that there were standing orders where the books that were decided that were going to come to the library were decided by the suppliers, not so much by the staff. What we've done is we've changed that. We've focused more on what the community wants, doing community assessments, staff reaching out, and now the staff purchases the books, decides on the books themselves. And what that has done is it has really increased our circulation by thousands, because now we're getting books that are more geared for the community and the residents of North Reading. And we also have found, thanks to Danielle in Youth Services, she has much more diverse collection than we used to have, so we are reaching out, trying to reach as many people as we can. And the proof is in the numbers. So overall, state circulation numbers, it's down over the last 2 years. According to the Mass Board of Library Commissioners, circulation has gone down. Even though libraries are being used in lots of different ways, circulation has gone down over the last 2 years. However, the Flint Memorial Library, our print circulation materials are up 5%, and our downloadables, our ebooks, our audiobooks are up 16%. So people are coming to the library and getting excited and using our materials, and I think a lot of it has to do with more care, more focus in the collection. So new for patrons. We purchased a telescope that patrons can check out for 1 week. It's a big Star Blaster telescope. People are really excited about it, and something you can take home. So Chromebooks. We have been collaborating with the middle school, doing a lot of collaboration with the schools. In the middle school, they have a seventh grade initiative that all students are using Chromebooks in the classroom, using them for instruction and then using them for homework. What we've done is purchased five, the exact same Dell Chromebooks that anyone can use at the library, so they can seamlessly come to the library and finish their homework or their projects, and they can do it after school, in the evening, and the weekends, and they're able to go and just work on their projects or whatever they're doing. And it's not just for kids. Anyone can use those in the library. Everyone's welcome to use them. And finally, we put this on here because it's a really minor purchase. We purchased a scanner. A lot of patrons have been asking us for a scanner. We purchased the scanner, and it has been an overwhelming response. People are coming in and bringing their pictures and scanning their pictures, using it for genealogy, looking up for documents, and so people are finding this really, really popular. And we actually have two programs coming up, two-part series about DNA. So, you know, now you've had your DNA tested, now what are you going to do with it? So people are really interested in genealogy, and just having that scanner there has become really popular. People are thrilled that they can come in and work on their personal items. Does anyone have any questions so far?
Sharon, regarding the scanner, does the library charge?
We do not.
You do not?
We do not, and they can scan right to the computer, scan to email, and we do not charge a fee for that. Yes, Mike?
You already purchased the hardware?
The scanner?
And the Chromebooks?
Correct.
So they're not in this budget?
They are not in that. They are not for the FY18 budget, yes. So youth services, what we've done to grow youth services, we started doing Saturday spectaculars. Again, we have an amazing youth services department. They really, really are in touch with what's going on and what the town is looking for. And we found that a lot of parents who work during the week want to be able to do things with their kids on the weekends. So we started the Saturday spectaculars, and they've been hugely popular. One of them is the story walk they did at Ipswich River Park. It got everyone out of the library, and families went to Ipswich River Park and had storyboards set up along the park, and they read a story as they walked along. And what we found is that it wasn't just families that did it. There were couples, there were elderly people. I mean, there were people really, really enjoying that story walk in Ipswich River Park. So the youth services department is constantly trying to find the best things that they can do to reach the widest audience and, again, maximizing the budget that we have. Summer reading, as you can see in the bottom in the slides, that it has grown exponentially in the last 3 years. A lot of it is, again, we have started collaborating with the schools. This summer we're actually going to be collaborating with K-8, so it's going to be even bigger. It just continues to expand. And businesses and residents actually give, it was solicited, so the youth services went out and solicited. And residents and businesses were very gracious and generous and gave prizes that kids could win. So kids would read and they would get a raffle ticket toward a really great prize, like a Kindle or a bike at the end of the year. So that has increased participation and anything to kids excited about reading, so we'll do that. All right, 2017 and beyond. We are doing the 17 and 17 reading challenge again this year. We had done it 15 and 15 and then 16 and 16, and we were going to try something different, but so many people came in and asked us to start it, begged us to start it, that we decided that we would do it again in addition to trying other things. So it's really popular. People love, they read their books, they get a raffle ticket for what they read. We have programs and events that we do around the reading challenge. It's really brought a lot of people together. We've had over 200 adults participating in it each year, and they continue it through the whole year and really, really enjoy it. They feel like it gives them a reason to read and they get to be a part of a group, so we're continuing that. The Gordon Ivester Author Series, I very subtly put my poster over there. There is a man, Gordon Ivester, he was a resident of North Reading, and he passed away almost 2 years ago, and he was an avid reader, enjoyed the library, and he left $10,000 to the library to be used in any way we wanted to use it. And we met with his nephew, who was the executor, Dean Van Norden, and we decided that the best way that we could reach the most people would be to do an author series and really look at the town and make sure we had different kinds of authors, different kinds of audiences, and reach the most demographics. So we're really excited about that. And tomorrow night is our kickoff. Mitchell Zuckoff is going to be coming. He's a BU professor, and he wrote 13 Hours, the true account of what happened in Benghazi, and also Lost in Shangri-La, and that's a World War II story. And since Gordon Ivester was a World War II veteran, it's a really nice way to kick off the series, nice tribute to him. So we're also looking forward to Symphony, which any of you, hopefully all of you, use the library. We have an evergreen system now that you go on and you order your books and the catalog. It's going to be changing in May to something new called Symphony through the Merrimack Valley Library Consortium. And it's going to be a better system, they tell us, better, faster, stronger. I don't know, but it is replacing it, and there's going to be a learning curve. The staff is going to training, and then the staff is going to be teaching patrons, because it does affect everyone, because every single person who uses the library will no longer be able to use Evergreen. They'll have to learn a new system. So as always, our staff, we have a terrific staff who goes above and beyond to learn what they can and do what they can. And we are going to have training sessions, like I said, and then they'll be training the patrons. But that's going to take a lot of time up for us in April, May, and June. And finally, the strategic plan. We are working on a strategic plan, a five-year plan. It's due in October. We have a strategic planning committee made up of trustees, friends of the library, staff, different adults with different demographics, different ages, and also a small business owner to get different input from the town, where we're going to go in the next 5 years. And the town is going to be changing and growing. We want to make sure that we are more than prepared to meet those needs. This is my monkey side. Okay, so we know that the building is a very historic building, a beautiful old building built in 1875. However, we want everyone to know that our services can be accessed 24/7. Anything that you need, kids are doing reports. You can't use Google, you can't use Wikipedia, but we have statewide research databases that you can access at night, on the weekends, and they can do their reports. You can access consumer reports. You can reserve a museum pass. You can download books from Zinio, which is a digital platform for magazines. We have, I think, 70 magazines that are on that. There's no limit to how many magazines you get, and this is all free. Freegal is downloading music. So we just want to let you know that the library is accessible to you 24/7 and can offer so many things. Just by going to the website, it's a portal to all the information and all the offerings. So historic building, but very modern services. And finally, just want another plug. Tomorrow night starts the Gordon Ivester author series with Mitchell Zakoff. We hope that you will attend, hope that you will come and meet Dean Van Norden, who is the executor, and also listen to Mitchell Zakoff. I heard he's quite a speaker, and he's going to talk about his books, and we hope that you will join us for the first of the Gordon Ivester author series. So thank you, and do you have any questions?
Michael?
Yes. The reason I asked the question was, you said in your FY18 budget you wanted to purchase the Chromebooks and the scanner and a few other things, but if we've already purchased the money for the FY17, I'm a little confused.
They were purchased
from the Iowa City, correct? Correct. So it was in the narrative of what we wanted to do, and so the scanner was $70, and not a very expensive scanner, but the Chromebooks are expensive. So it was in our narrative of what we were going to do for FY18. We had decided that we can use state aid and purchase them so that the kids could start using them, because it was an initiative for the middle school to be using them. So it doesn't affect the budget as far as the operating budget, because it is coming out of state aid.
No, it's good. I support it. I just didn't see it. I heard you say it in there, but I didn't see the money in there, so I was a little disconnected. The second question I have is electronic subscriptions. So last year it was a little over $1,900, mm-hmm. and this year it's another $450. Is this the trend that we're going to continue to see with this? And is there a return on that investment?
Definitely. So electronic subscriptions can encompass a lot of things. The additional $450 for next year is Wowbrary, which is a service that we have had for the past couple of years, and people can sign up for it, and they get a weekly email of all the items that have been added to the collection, and you can immediately go right in and request it, or go to the catalog, or look at the library. This is the third year that we have had it. The Friends of the Library paid for it for the first 2 years, and then said that they can no longer continue to cover that, and asked if we could put it in our operating budget, which 99% of libraries do. It is considered something that's definitely a value, definitely a benefit, and we want us to continue to provide that for the patrons.
So is that the average price, about $1,250?
That's
not
correct.
The $1,900. What was the $1,900 last year compared to this year?
Well, that's an additional $450. And
what will we see next year? The year after FY19? Will we still see $450, or will we see something more?
No, you will see, it's $450 plus, when we look at the budget, $1,900 for the electronic subscriptions. I'm sorry? 51?
The primary request is $5,150.
Okay. So that covers our consumer reports.
Okay.
our Fregal, our Zinios, the electronic subscriptions that you're seeing there that are used and absolutely have value to the residents. If there are other electronic subscriptions, we would decide if it's worth it, decide if the community wants it, if it's worth the money, and then bring that to you. But
there's no fee, right, for the user?
There's no fee for any of it. It is all free to
Harry?
To patrons with the library card.
I have a question about the online subscriptions we've just been discussing.
Mm-hmm.
Do you have any way of tracking our residents' use of those? In other words, you know, is it 10 people a year that go online and try and access Consumer Report, or?
Yes, I didn't bring that with me. I could get that, but yes, we do keep track of that, and each year the state requires that we submit a report, an ARIS report, and it talks about the usage, and it includes all of that. So we do get statistics that will show how much they're being used, and we do look at that every year to decide if it's worth keeping a database or not having a database. We had done that with our museum passes. We looked at the usage, and there was one of the museums that was just not being used, so we decided not to renew it. So we do take a look at that every year before we renew. We don't do it blindly.
All right, thank you.
Thank you.
Any other questions for Sharon? Jeff?
Yes. Well, first of all, thank you for running a spectacular program.
Thank you.
I think my question to you is, you know, with all the things that you're working on, with all the things that you're being very creative to present to the residents of the town, is there something on here, or that's not on here, that you have in the back of your mind that you feel that if we had that, or if we could do that, it would really make things a lot better or more effective, or more efficient? Is there anything that you have in the back?
A wish list?
Yeah, well, anything from your wish list. How's that sound? Okay.
Yeah. Not sure I can think of that off the top of my head. I'll actually put that out to the staff. But one thing I think of quickly is that the logistics of the building are not really set up for the way the library is used today, and that's something that we are looking at. You know, the teams are on one floor. We want them to be able to talk loudly and collaborate, because that's how you study now and how you learn is through collaboration. And we also have a different floor where it's very quiet. And libraries aren't quiet anymore, but some people do come in there to work, and we do have to have a quiet space. So we are looking at, and part of the strategic plan is to look at how the library is being used today and how to reuse space. So that's something I know that if we had money, we would love to be able to address.
Sharon, what's the status of the elevator at this point?
The elevator gives us problems weekly. It seems to always be something different. And now we're still having trouble. It's a new problem where the fire light goes on and one of the firefighters has to come and shut it off and actually reset the entire elevator in the mechanical room to get it going again. They don't know why it's doing that. So it is the busier the library gets, the more people are concerned, because it has problems regularly.
And what steps are we taking?
I know that Julie, DPW, she's been on top of it, and I know they have repair companies come out. Mike, I don't mean to put that on you, but I don't know if it's anything has moved on. They come every time and they look at it, but yes, but they haven't determined any other big problems, so I don't know. But it is constant.
It had gotten pretty bad, and there was talks about needing to put a new control unit in. Did that get done?
Yes, I believe they did that.
And since then, we're still having weekly issues?
Different issues, yes. It seems to be always something new.
Fire alarm, red light coming on, I think it's part of the controller or sensors that are.
Possibly. That
seems to me we need to get more aggressive with the people that did the initial repairs there to get them fixed for good. The elevator should just run.
We feel that way as well. it makes a lot of noises. It does jump a little bit. So there are things we've learned to live with, but there are sometimes people are not comfortable who are in it.
Logistically, then, are you kind of put in a position where you have to consider the seniors and their circumstances with the elevator? Because you can't put their books on the top floor, obviously. So have you considered, or have you already reconfigured some of the levels to senior programs on the either the bottom or on the main floor?
I'm not sure I understand you.
Well, if the elevator's not working, right, constantly giving you a hard time, you're going to wind up with a scenario if seniors are using it and somebody's stuck on the top floor,
right,
and the elevator's not working, that's an issue. Or they come in and they can't get to the top,
mm-hmm,
floor. So have you given thought to reconfiguring your floor arrangements, as you alluded to a little bit earlier,
right.
Kind of subdue the problem with the elevator by having seniors, right, kids can, you know, we know kids can go up and down,
right?
You know, so
yes.
Does it make sense to you?
It does. We look at that as two separate issues. So the first issue is, we talk about repurposing the library for how it's used, and that's when we're talking about, you know, possibly moving the public computers all downstairs so that people can talk and, you know, share information and read the newspaper and not have to be quiet. And that has made it's more possible now, because when we did get our IT upgrade, we have a lot of access points and Wi-Fi, so we don't have to be tied to a cord in the floor, a cable in the floor anymore, so we can move things around. So we are looking at that as far as usage. What you're talking about, the other thing is we actually have a plan in place. It happens so frequently that it's actually hard having the children's room on the fourth floor because people have carriages and babies, so that actually makes it very difficult as well. We do have all the large print books on the first floor to make it easier for seniors. And we do have plans in place that when the elevator is not working well, someone will run and get books for people, find books for people. We just make sure that we help every patron who comes in so they don't have to not be able to use the services because of the elevator. But it is an issue. It continues to be an issue.
And you indicated that the problems that you're having now with the elevator are different problems than the problems we were having before, right?
That is correct.
Okay.
I don't know if it's from the same origin. I just know that it's considered a different problem.
Sounds like a lemon to me.
Is the maintenance and repair of the elevator outside of the library budget?
It is, yes. It's covered in the town building's budget.
So we can talk about that when we get to town buildings.
I'll follow up with the building superintendent with regard to what the plan is for addressing the issue.
DPW has been very responsive to us. It just, once something gets fixed, another thing seems to happen, so.
It's the frequent, you know, elevators on occasion act up, and they get either recycled or something gets fixed. The switch is not working, but this seems to be too frequent. So
I
think we need to
take
a closer look at it. Any other questions for Sharon regarding the library operation?
Just as far as the leaking roof, you had to operate around that.
I don't think we've had trouble with the roof.
We were okay last summer because we were in the middle of a drought.
Right, yes. Yeah, we did have some trouble and they had to take down the ceiling and cover the books, but we haven't had anything with that lately, fortunately.
Any other questions for Sharon?
Thank you.
Thank you
very much.
Thank you very much.
For all the programming, it's response has been terrific in the community.
Thank you very much.
The next is Youth Services. Did I get that right? Youth Services? Am I falling out of order here?
No, Youth Services is next.
Yeah,
so
I got it right.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Mary
switching.
Oh,
yeah. No.
How much is it worth, Mary? How much is it worth?
10% reduction.
Services to my elder community, Mr. Sir.
Okay. You have the floor.
Thank you.
I got to go look that one up.
This is not nice.
Someone got a page number for that.
Okay. Thank you, everyone. And thank you, Amy, for letting me cut. I have a meeting today later on with my friends at the Council of Aging, and they're always happy to give me money.
Oh, yes.
So I want to make sure that I'm there to entertain their offerings. The town of North Reading has an ever-growing elder population, as you know. In 2016, it made up 24.4% of our town's population. And with that, I mean 60 years and older. That is an increase of 1.9% over last year. The department has provided over $1 million worth of services to North Reading residents, including people with disabilities under 60 years of age. These services have been provided in partnership with Mystic Valley Elder Services. With this partnership, we were able to help 37 residents who are eligible for nursing facility care remain in their homes in North Reading, which is where we all want to be, so we're happy to do that. With funding from state formula grant monies, we have been able to reach out to over 2,200 elders through our quarterly newsletter, and I'm happy to say in late September 2016, we hired our first ever outreach assistant to work 15 hours a week, which is a state-funded position. She's already provided new services to many North Reading residents, either through intake calls directly to the senior center or referrals from the police and fire departments. As you know, the Department of Elder Affairs serves the most venerable, poorest, and frailest members of our community. We've requested a level service budget with a small increase of $440. That includes...
Outrageous.
I know, it's outrageous. $200 for basically a guesstimate on vehicle supplies, some more money in travel, and an increase in our dues. So it is a very simple budget. I think it's reasonable, and I wonder if anyone has any questions on this.
Jeff?
Yeah, let me ask you the same question. Okay, that I asked the library director. You presented a budget, it's a nice budget, but we know that you are often in need of more.
All the time.
And I would like to know, give me two things that you feel that you need that either is not on here or more should be considered.
Well, that could have been put in my capital request for obviously a brand new senior center that would entail more than one floor and an old building where the second floor is contaminated, yes.
Yeah.
A new building would be wonderful. And we'd be able to provide a lot more services at night and ongoing services during the day.
And I agree with you on that, but I'm looking for something a little bit more reasonable.
A little bit more reasonable? I see with the elder population growing in town, maybe an increase in staff in a year or two to come to handle some of the ongoing problems that we're going to see with this population, basically in social services. The numbers are growing, people's needs are going to be greater, and there are going to be more phone calls and more needs that have to be addressed. So it would probably be staffing.
Mary, we've got a new van.
Yes, we do.
How is that working?
It is working out fine.
Right. No issues with it?
We have had no issues with it. We had a few in the beginning, but we were able to figure it out because it was a new van with a new first model off the line, but we were able to get out all the little problems that it had with it, and so far we've had no problems with the van.
And drivers for it?
We have a driver. Our full-time driver has been out on long-term disability and sick leave. We have had a driver who has been filling in temporary and things have been working out. We did cut our hours just a bit to make things work, but we've been lucky. We've been able to serve anyone who's called and needed a ride. And plus, as you know, we work with Christian Community Services, that we do a lot of work with volunteers that provide out-of-town medical services. So we're able to, thanks to the great volunteers in North Reading, be able to help get people to medical services when needed. Out of town. So that's been successful.
Mr. Prisco.
Somewhat related, somewhat unrelated question for you. You know, I've said this before for many different reasons, but as you know, the town is land rich and cash poor. And the issue about senior housing is always a discussion, right? And I really think FY18 is a great year for us to make a commitment for us to sit down, maybe in a smaller setting, to think about what land is really available and get an RFP on the street for the first time in a long time to see if we can find someone that we can turn that land over to give us a proposal to bid some senior housing. We have the land, it's around, and you know one piece that I think we've talked about privately. I think this is the year we need to do it. And we focused a lot of attention on the J.T. Berry. I think that's behind us now pretty much. We can move some of our attention over now to do something for the seniors.
I think this is wonderful news. As you know, our housing authority, which is state-owned run, PBD Court Housing, is over 50 years old. The state doesn't have any money to refurbish. If some of you
right.
went in and saw some of these homes, you would just be amazed at what poor condition it is in. As a elected official, actually, as the housing authority, we only have so much money. So we have to focus on roofs, furnaces, and not on other upgrades. Yes, there is a need. I think there are other ways of looking at senior housing, not necessarily public housing. There are people in North Reading, huge amount of people who are rich house, income poor. They want to downsize. There's no place to go. They want to live in their communities, the ones that they built, the churches that they go to. So there is a great need to come up with a plan of some sort of new type of senior housing, affordable senior housing, not right. necessarily low income, but affordable, reasonable housing to allow this 24.4% of the people, and it's growing, it's going to be probably 40% in another 10 years, to be able to remain in their community, because that's what community is.
Yeah.
It's, you know, schools, their kids, and their older adults.
Well, I'm committed, so whenever you're ready, I'm more than willing to make the time to
I'll
sit
pick
down.
You up, you can get your hammer and nails ready, Michael.
I think we should do it. We should challenge the town administrator to sit with us and to draft an RFP.
I mean, there are many various ways of housing. It doesn't necessarily have to be low income. There are other communities that do it, and it's just coming up what is really needed for North Reading, out of the box thinking, because North Reading is a very unique community. As you know, North Reading has no home. We're kind of north of Boston, south of Merrimack, you know, west and north shore. We're a unique community, so we have to figure out how to make this work for the best of all of our citizens. Because remember, what's good for old age is good for young age and all ages, no matter what. So
I'm committed.
Talk a little bit about transportation. One van, I'm sure that there's a bigger need.
Transportation,
especially for out of town.
Transportation is huge, and it's even going to be basically bigger if this new 455 units come into town. We have one van. We only do in-town transportation. Thanks again to our wonderful volunteers who volunteer outside of medical appointments. We can't do much. There's a lot of controversy going on now with the Council on Aging that the MBTA, even though we don't have the ride, which is like probably a good thing because we don't have to worry about this now, but the MBTA is coming in and asking Council on Agents to take over a great deal of their ride requirements because they're trying to cut down funding. So transportation is the biggest problem in North Reading, it's the biggest problem in the state, and it's the biggest problem in the country. So it's huge.
Mr. Chairman?
Mr. Yule?
Going back to the ride, you just said something interesting to me that actually sounds a little bit more concerning than anything else. Are you saying that, because we don't have the ride, but they're asking other towns to take over?
This is the big scuttlebutt that's going on now because the MBTA is looking at cutting funding.
Right.
So they're looking at Council on Aging to take on more of the responsibility to reporting, to helping people provide rides that the ride would normally do. So it's asking Council on Aging in municipalities, cities, and towns to take on the responsibility that the ride would have. So that would mean more van transportation, trying to figure out how to get people to and from medical transportation. And as you know, the ride not only does medical transportation, the ride will take you wherever you want to go. If it would take you in the city of Boston to Fenway Park in North Reading, if you wanted to go to Fenway, if we had the ride in North Reading and we wanted to go to Fenway Park, they would take you to Fenway Park. But this is going to be a big problem. Transportation's huge, especially with the T funding, you know, cutting funds.
So that's changing. They're becoming more like us. Well, the future indicating that they're becoming
well,
more
it looks
like
they're becoming more like us. And of course, none of the cities and towns are prepared with the funding to even do this, and not to mention the Council on Aging having to take this on is huge.
That's concerning.
This is all proposed, but this is what the scuttlebutt and all the emails have been going back and forth with.
That's not encouraging to the extent that you know, we've often said, you know, why don't we have the ride? Why don't we have the ride? Now, if we get the ride, we're going to wind up in the same situation that
absolutely,
we're still in.
Absolutely.
That doesn't sound
good at
all.
When I had to respond to one of the emails, it was like, well, this is kind of good news. I don't have to worry about this because we don't have the ride. So, but it's bad news for a lot of other communities. There's
Mary,
no funding.
Do we have data on just how much use, operating hours, the van is actually on?
We do. I don't have them with me. I mean, it varies from day to day and season to season. If we have
some kind of averages,
it can vary greatly, because if we have one or two seniors who take the van every day to the senior center, then maybe somewhere else, and that senior is no longer with us or taking that ride, it can change. So I don't have numbers exactly with me. We were able, thank God, because having our full-time van driver not with us, be able to kind of cut down some hours and make more restrictions on people. If they wanted to go somewhere, this is the time you have to do it.
I guess my question is, we have a van, and we pay for a driver.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, outside of the fact that we have a driver out. But under normal situations, we have a driver for 35 hours a week,
right,
or more?
35 hours a week is a normal time.
We don't provide the rider on the weekends? Or
no.
And, you know, I'm kind of interested in, you know, how much of it is just, how much time is it just sitting still? What are the types of users? What are they asking the ride for? I think
it varies from day to day.
If we're going to give any thought to transportation, we need to understand, you know, what,
mm-hmm,
what people are looking for.
What
now.
They're looking for. A lot of the calls are basically out of town services. Whether it's going
which
in.
Which we don't do at all.
Which we don't do. We're very lucky. Like I said, we do have volunteers who will drive people to medical appointments. We're very limited. I think we have one person who will drive into Boston to a Boston hospital, and that's as long as he's not away on vacation. And a lot of people don't realize that we don't even have transportation. They assume that it's here one way or another. So when they call, it's trying to scramble for a volunteer ride or trying to offer them something else.
Mr. Chair.
Mr. Yule.
Yeah. When they volunteer, are they using their own vehicle?
Yes, they are. It was what they used to have through Christian Community Service. It was called FISH years ago. And a few years back, we agreed to take this off. We got permission to take this over because Christian Community Service people no longer had the volunteers to run the service themselves, because we have to take calls, we have to find some volunteers, we have to match them up and make it work.
It's not very encouraging.
Yeah, sorry. Just in relation, I mean, today they had the fiscal advisory board for the MBTA had a hearing on, among other things, you know, cutting weekend service, but also
yeah,
the ride, the impact that was going to have. A lot of people went and testified today urging them to take another look at their ideas of cutting, you know, the ride. And while we don't have it, we would hope that it would at some point in time expand into our community.
Mm-hmm.
That doesn't look likely at all. And as far as the current federal administration's proposals to cut Meals on Wheels, and I know it comes through Mystic Valley, what's the level of concern at Mystic Valley's level
in relation to
those proposals and the impact that it could have on our community? I mean, I know the services.
I actually had a call today with Dan O'Leary, who's the executive director of Mystic Valley Elder Services, and of course that's one of our major concerns. A while back, one of the concerns coming out of the federal government was that they were going to cut all our SHINE counseling, and SHINE is very important. Those are the people who figure out what type of insurance helps people get services they need. So it's very concerning. We'll be meeting with the board meeting next week with Mystic Valley to see how to take this. We have, I think this morning, we had 28 people getting Meals on Wheels. That's down than we had previously, which is either probably a good thing, which means people don't need the services as much. But there's still a lot of people every day that's getting that meal, that knock on the door. And
it's more than just a warm meal.
It's not the warm meal. It's an outreach worker. It's our outreach worker who knocks on that door of those 28 homes to find out what's going on in that person's life every day. Which we wouldn't be able to do.
But again, when it comes to Mystic Valley and those types of services, we're talking about Meals on Wheels, we're talking about Medicare.
Devastating.
Cutbacks, and,
devastating.
You know, obviously, the impact on the state budget.
Yeah. Devastating.
The impact on every community.
Yeah, to this population, not only to the older population. You have to remember there's a trickle-down effect, because if the older population's not getting their services, then their children, who were trying to help them out, they're being affected by that, because it's going to cost them more time probably in helping to finance these things, or helping taking time off from work, or somehow providing services in other ways. It could be devastating.
So this should be a plug from the local level up.
Absolutely. That's a no-brainer. We know what the right thing is to do.
And again, I think at some point, Mr. Chairman, we should evaluate it and craft a letter to our legislators and state level, the federal level, and then all the way up to the administration, the president. because the impact on our community is going to be significant if what he's proposing right now goes through. And we're certainly not prepared to adapt overnight.
Oh, no, I showed you before with the services that are provided from Mystic Valley Elder Services. There's no way that the town of North Reading would be able to in any way supplement those costs and provide those services.
Any other questions?
Just one quick thing on the transportation. So it's been 13 years since we've done we've updated our master plan for the town, mm-hmm. where we talk about transportation. It's pretty outdated, but we did approve money in the CPC budget, or we're hopefully going to approve the money to do update that master plan, and the transportation piece is a big part of that.
Yes.
And obviously your input is going to be important, and I'm
sure
Danielle
yeah.
will see you to get that. And we're also working on getting some grants. We've already got some grant money to study the transportation.
Mm-hmm.
So work has started, but we're also going to need your
It's
your
been
input.
Great progress in the last 13 years. I would say the last year or two has been extremely exciting and promising for the elders in North Reading.
I think we're going to get there.
Any other questions for Mary? I guess we can't criticize your budget very much.
Oh, well, thank you, gentlemen.
For the presentation.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you, Mary.
Thank you,
Thanks, Mary.
Youth Services. Anytime you're ready.
Okay. So I did for you another infographic that Mr. Yule tends to like every year. And you'll see in the attachments that I gave you, it's very difficult for me to separate work that I do for Youth Services and work for the Community Impact Team. So you have two infographics this year. One is really focused on Youth Services, which I'll start with. And then also the second page is related to Community Impact Team. And the last one, in case you're curious about where I am with school, I'm carrying a 4.0. Northeastern. It's been a challenge, but I'm very grateful, and I'm ahead of schedule, actually. So it's going very well. So starting with Youth Services, a couple of things just to highlight. The mentor program, typically spring session is an 8-week session versus a 10-week session, and typically it's actually my slowest session, and we're actually slammed. Starting next week, I have 52 students starting on Wednesdays for an 8-week session. So that alone offers not just opportunities for the mentees, but also the mentors. As the students get in the crunch and they do their community service hours, I get more and more phone calls. Social services calls is par this year, and so it's projected to pass last year, as you see 101, 101. I'll just note that that does not include calls that I receive from families about the same issue. So for example, if family A calls me about a domestic violence issue and then they call for follow-up and follow-up and follow-up, I don't note those as three separate calls. That's just one call. Overall enrollment is likely to hit last year's numbers. It could be slightly down. It depends on what goes on for April vacation and for summer programming. And a couple of my favorite programs I wanted to talk about this year. And the first is the mentor program has really expanded. The middle school has an increase in enrollment with children with diverse abilities. They called on me and said, are you able to accommodate some of those children in the mentor program? And I'm happy to say we have been able to do that. Right now, we have children on the autism spectrum, a child with Down syndrome, a child who's wheelchair bound, and also a child with a seizure disorder. And we were able to accommodate that. Massive shout out to the students that work with me and their patients. They're not trained in that, but they work with me to accommodate those students. The reality fair this year was my favorite program so far. We welcomed the entire junior class to the reality fair, and I will thank many people in this room who volunteered, members from the board, members from the finance committee, members from community impact team, from Rotary, and including my department head peers as well. Youth Services, we had across the board such a great representation from the community, and I hope you enjoyed working at that or attending that. Mr. Prisco had some interesting questions over in life insurance that were pretty creative. We did get the approval from Mr. Lepret that we'll be doing this again next year for the entire junior class, and I am very happy about that. It was entirely funded from a gift from NORCAM, which I will mention did close its doors officially after 7 years. Their intent was to start Youth Services, and that's done, so then they closed that. So we completely funded that, so I hope you enjoyed that. Let's see, coming up in partnership or in complement to the Reality Fair, we're looking to offer two financial workshops. Interestingly enough, this has been the number one requested presentation by parents, not by students, but by parents who have said we need more of financial literacy happening in the community. So our first will be probably around what does it mean to take out a loan, and the second will be somewhat related around credit and what does your credit mean. This will be marketed towards all juniors and seniors as they go on to college and get prepared for that. Hopefully we'll be reintroducing Keeping Kids Safe. That's the Talk About Touching curriculum, which we were very successful, and it sold out last time we did it. We'll be doing that in partnership with the youth services at the library. Through the Drug Free Communities program, we'll be offering a parenting program called Guiding Good Choices. This is also going to be run by volunteers at the middle school level, and that's come about because of my involvement at the middle school council. This year, we celebrate the 10th anniversary of Battle of the Bands. So this is my fourth year starting in May, but 10th anniversary of Battle of the Bands. So we're looking to do an unplugged version, partly for my ears, but something different.
Acoustic?
Looking to do that the first week of June.
Do you mean acoustic?
Yes, yeah. Acoustic and a cappella.
Yeah.
So, yeah, you've been. And the last thing I'll just note related to moving on for next year is a focus on grandparents. Grandparents are getting really hit right now with raising grandchildren. Most of the time, 99% of the time, because their adult children are suffering from drug addiction disorders. It's very difficult to quantify this number. This is something that Mary Perney and I are working on together to quantify that number. I recently spoke to DA Ryan's office, and we are going to be engaging some free programming from her office to educate parents, grandparents, not just on the dangers of substances and how to keep their now young grandchildren safe, but also on what are the current trends in parenting. They might have not parented for a good 30 years or more, and we need to get some those grandparents some more services and support. Let's see, what else? Oh, I want to thank everybody for the Elder Services van. There was a question about what happens in the off hours of that. I do use that on occasion for evening field trips, and that has saved me a great deal of money actually passing that cost forward to the students. We have not had to do that half as much as we have in the past. And I will thank everybody also because we have a full youth services committee, and I will give a shout out to our volunteers, many of whom are here now. We have a full committee who is very active, very supportive, and they ask really great questions.
Amy.
Yes.
When you talk about the van, you're talking about the van that used to be the...
So usually I use the old van, but I have had to use the new van.
You're using both then.
Yes. The old van is the first one that I go to. Mm-hmm. But if I have a day trip, obviously the new van is in service, so that doesn't work. It did break down on me in Maine, in the whitewater rafting trip. Luckily, it broke down on me while I was at a gas station. So that helped.
I hope you bought a lottery ticket.
I should have, right now.
The force is with you.
Good. Yes. And also, I just wanted to give a really brief review. If you look at the CIT highlights, we do have three very active subcommittees. We actually have more than three active subcommittees, but these are the subcommittees that meet regularly. A lot going on. Obviously, the biggest funding change is the Drug-Free Communities Grant, which we were able to secure. Thank you to everybody in this room for supporting at the TA's office, Liz Paveo, who helps with me daily almost right now, dealing with the federal government. Has been a challenge, I'll be honest with you. We've had a lot of challenges dealing with their automated systems. So that's been a little bit tough. We were able to hire Leah Mayos full-time, completely funded by the grant, including her benefits and including OPEB was included in that. And we also do have a youth social media coordinator who posts at least three times a week. It's a student, we pay her $20 a week, $20 a month to post three times a week. And we're looking to, for the next grant cycle, to actually add in and hire a teacher who will be able to coordinate an entire youth-run program just for drug prevention. I would love to tell you, too, that you know we have numbers related to substance use in town, but truth is we just submitted that survey 2 weeks ago. It's at the evaluator right now. Hopefully, I would love to come and do another presentation on that and let you know how we're doing compared to others in the state, but also nationally. I'll tell you that I know tobacco use is down, vaping is up, alcohol use is about par, marijuana is slightly higher, and I'm really curious about the prescription drugs because I don't know anything about that yet.
Jeff?
Yes. Fantastic job.
Thanks.
Okay. With regard to your budget here. Mm-hmm. It's awfully low, okay? So meaning you're pretty lean and very mean. Always a very lean and nicely mean. If you can get that out right. So a lot of a significant part of your funding is through the grants, correct? I mean, I'm only seeing, I'm seeing here, I'm seeing salary, and then I'm seeing other numbers.
Okay? Yes, so the grant does not supplement any or provide any youth service support. The grant is entirely on youth substance prevention, so things like presentations, I don't need to put that into my youth services budget because it's paid for that.
Okay.
But I can't use, like, let's say I want to have a snack for the kids, they still want to eat during programs, that comes out of youth services, not the grant.
Okay, so I guess then that leads me into the question I've been asking everybody. What youth services in this case more than perhaps the others needs to be effective. And you can be efficient, but you really need to be. What you do has to have an effect on the people that you are taking care of for the community. So with that in mind, what do you need that would make you, A, more effective, reach more people from us? I mean, I'm talking dollars and cents and whatever specific program that you said, just if I had this program or what have you, okay?
Yes. So that's basically. I'm gonna throw one out there. And the first one is manpower, or volunteers. I mean, I think that I'm pretty decent at asking people to volunteer, and I'm pretty decent at asking sponsorships, and that's why I haven't had to come to you asking for money for speakers and things like that. But manpower. So there are ideas that I have, but if we just, our youth services committee volunteers, the community impact team staff volunteers, but just the administrative work alone that takes up time that I could be with the kids, that can be a little challenging sometimes. And somewhat parallel is space. So I love my new office space. Don't get me wrong, love that, but it did shrink the meeting room space. Parks and Rec is very welcoming for me to go over the rec center, but they're all toddler and school age seats, and so I have teenagers who are often, most of the time, taller than me, and that can be a challenge. This school has been very welcoming, but off hours, that's a little difficult. We do have the gym here that I could use, which I do use that, but also the library. So if those aren't available, just having our own space that we could have our own stuff in, getting back to the whole idea of the community center, of an intergenerational center, would be awesome. That's my best case scenario. But manpower, staff, anybody who could handle the volunteer stuff, the things like entering data in for enrollments, managing the website, things like that. And it's very difficult. I mean, I mentioned before, it's difficult for me to separate what I do for CIT versus youth services. To me, it's all the same mission. Even if it was to be somebody who could support the CIT administrative stuff, then that would come off of my plate and I would be able to be with the kids more too.
Why don't you bring that up at the next meeting?
I will. At the next CIT meeting?
Yes.
Yes. Yeah.
Thank you.
Just one quick question. Overall, with the grant money and all that you do, I mean, we have a budget in front of us for $56,000 or something.
Right.
But, I mean, how much do you really oversee and expend annually now with the grant money?
So add on $125,000 a year, right, and then add on roughly, Mr. Mysteri might know as well, maybe annually, maybe another $15,000 for CIT gifts. Would you say 15 to 20, depending on the year?
Yeah, well, that's exclusive of state money that I think is dried up.
I was gonna say, and I'm not counting state money. That was $20,000, an additional $20,000. We get about $15,000 to $20,000 in gifts a year.
And then, National Night Out, the police department has funds.
That doesn't come out of the police funds, actually. Usually that comes out of sponsorships and gifts now.
It's almost $200,000
yeah,
as far as operational programming that come under your umbrella. And I think it's important for people to understand that it's youth services that you're presenting here now, but you wear several hats and the umbrella is pretty big as far as what the responsibilities are.
Yeah.
A lot of volunteers
and donations.
About, with the grant money now, almost $200,000.
Yes.
That's terrific.
Yeah, I think that that's what I was kind of alluding to, because it looked awfully small for what she does, you know, so.
But keep in mind that we wouldn't have that grant if we wouldn't have Amy, who put her heart and soul and went back and learned why we didn't get it the first year around.
Well, get ready, because there's another one I'm preparing for next year. A complimentary, being qualified for the Drug Free Communities Grant opened up the door for another grant called the STOP Grant, which is focused solely on alcohol prevention. We are not able to apply it for this year because they don't have those baseline numbers to say that we have a need, which is what I was alluding to before, that that survey just went out. It's at the evaluators. We'll miss the deadline. So I actually, for my class, I took a class on grant writing, and one of our assignments was to prepare a grant, and so I wrote the STOP grant, so it's ready to go. They'll probably tweak a couple of questions, but it counted as coursework, and we're going to be able to apply it here.
Fantastic.
Which was always the intention to do, so I'm really happy to be able to do that.
Do you think the term return on investment with Amy applies?
No.
Really? I mean, you think about it.
Without question.
I will say, too, this is the most generous community for volunteers and finances I've ever worked in. You know, if I just say I need one thing, somebody seems to find it or volunteer and step up. I mean, the reality fair took over 25 volunteers to pull that off, and they gave up an entire day to do that. That doesn't happen often, so that's huge.
Any other questions?
Any questions about CIT? I can speak a little bit to the other action teams if you have any questions about that.
Anybody? Thank you, Amy. Yes, next is town clerk, unless you swapped off with somebody.
No, I didn't swap
you
with anybody.
Not, okay.
So thank you for allowing us the time to present our budgets here tonight, and wish I had some exciting programs like the rest of them to run, but my stuff is kind of cut and dry. It's elections and census and town meetings and ethics and public records and open meeting law. So it's not as exciting as what some other departments offer, but definitely necessary to run town government. We've had a very busy year this past year with the three big elections, culminating with the presidential, of course. But the budget this coming year for FY18, luckily for the town, goes down. It decreases. So I bring great tidings for the town in the fact that my budget actually goes down. And that, of course, is due to just one election being funded this year. So our budget in the town clerk's office fluctuates drastically from year to year just based on the number of elections that we hold each year. So we're coming off of a year with three elections and going into a fiscal year with just one election, namely the town election next May. So the budget does reflect, you know, decreases in almost every area. Some of the decreases overlap between the elections budget and the records budget because the services are not so distinguishable. We, you know, the staff is the same staff that runs both programs together with myself. And some of the costs incurred from elections are actually borne in the records budget too. So they both fluctuate, you know, up and down with the election cycle. The records budget has contractual salary obligations that show an increase for that, but basically all other areas except one slight increase in dues membership shows a decrease in all of the records budget as well. And the elections budget, personnel, details, professional services for programming the voting machines, election specific supplies and such, all diminish with the decrease in elections. So we bring good news for the town in that way.
So Barbara, at the special town meeting, the staff were using iPads to check in.
Yes, we had our.
Can you talk a little bit about that?
Yes, I'd love to.
I mean, someone said there was a big long line out there.
You know, that's typical of a town meeting when we have a larger crowd, whether we were using the poll pads or voting lists. People come at 7 o'clock. They're not going to get there any earlier, if you notice, and that causes the backup. But the poll pads actually function better than the paper check-in because you don't have to know which precinct you're in. It's just straight alphabetical by name check-in process. So that's, you know, really goes smoothly. Probably if we had a couple more, it would go even more smooth. But those were purchased last year for early voting because they were approved by the Secretary of State's office for use in early voting. They realized the difficulties that early voting could cause in communities with check-in processes, especially for communities that had multiple sites for early voting, where they might have voted in, you know, maybe, you know, up to 10 locations for cities, you know. So the poll pads were a great benefit, especially in those communities, but even in our use here, they were just instrumental to the smooth flowing process of the check-in. I think people really enjoyed them. We did advise people that they could use their license to provide for a faster lookup because the poll pad has a camera, it's an iPad, and it will read the barcode on the license and pull their name up on the voting list, which is imported onto the poll pad. It is not connected anywhere to the web. It is an import, so the voting list exists only on that poll pad, so there's no threat of cybersecurity any kind of other integration to that unit. The nice thing about them, and this is where they were really beneficial for communities that early voted in multiple locations, is that they talk to each other, they communicate. So as soon as a person checks in on one poll pad, they are reflected on the other one. There's two different levels of poll pads. We did not need the level that communicated via the web because ours were in the same building. So they communicated to each other through our wireless in here. But that was the beauty of them. So you could check a person in on one end of town for some of these communities and it would show up on every other poll pad that was used throughout the city.
So do you have a plan to add to the two that you have?
Well, right now they are certified for use in early voting, which will only occur every 2 years in every November state election, as well as we can use them for town meetings. So right now I have them for, you know, I decided to use them for town meeting to get some more benefit out of them. To use them, and I expect that they will get certified for elections, but then that would be a bigger cost that I would have to say would go to a capital plan request because you would need multiple, probably two units per precinct just to have the flow. Just as we have two checkers for each precinct. And, you know, between the cost for the units plus the Wi-Fi capabilities in the church, we would have to ensure that we could tap into their Wi-Fi there.
Oh, you could bring one. You could bring something.
A hotspot or something like that. But that and then just the maintenance cost, the annual fee, for those poll pads. So all of that would be a consideration if we were to go forward in that venue. Right now, I do expect the certification process to take place. We all do because they've proven their worth and they've been tested and shown that they're truly reliable. We haven't seen that yet, so I don't have anything in this budget to go forward with anything more for that.
Abby?
Barbara, how many do you currently have?
Two. So what we did in early voting here, we used one for checking in the voters, and our counter had one for the people that were inactive voters, and we took care of those at our counter.
And what's the annual fee that you have to pay for whatever it is?
The maintenance fee is $250 per unit. The units themselves will be, the ones we purchased were $1,500, and the cloud-based units are 3,000 each.
What does the 250 do?
Well, they will import the voting list for us to get it set up for each election, each event, town meeting. So we deal with the company that supplies them for that.
And that's what they do?
That's what they do.
And how much are the units?
Pardon?
How much are the units?
1,500.
And do you buy those through the state?
No, this was bought through a vendor.
And do they have to be set up or programmed by the state in any way?
No, not by the state. We use our state-generated voting lists to be imported into them, but it's not done through the state. It's done through our vendor in conjunction with the manufacturer.
So for a town meeting, you would more reasonably be able to do your job with four, is that correct?
I think so. This past town meeting was a little exceptional. We haven't really tipped the scales with as many voters as we had this time, unfortunately, because that was only, I think, 205 voters. Back in the day, we used to have a better showing, as a lot of people will remember. But yeah, it would help it move quicker, you know, just by having four more, you know, two more, four lines. But that's not going to stop people from, you know, not showing up till 7 o'clock, because that's what a lot of people will do still.
I understand, but it's my memory, such as it is, that at the election, when you had one on either end, that you could not scan your driver's license at that point.
At the election, when I had the one?
Yeah.
I was using it as a lookup tool, because I could have used a license if I could have held it to be in range of the camera. When they're stationary on a table, there's a device that slides on the back to position a license exactly where the camera
but
will read it.
But the license scanning capability was not used at the last election that you had the two units.
At town meeting?
No, not town meeting.
At the election,
right.
The last election, I walked around with one unit to assist people in finding their precincts. So no, I did not scan their licenses there, correct. But
thank
the
you.
Check-ins were still physical, paper, voting list
right,
check-ins.
Right, right.
But the early voting, you did utilize them.
Yes, yep.
Yeah, you had to have a license for that,
early voting. And I mean, in Massachusetts, we're not allowed to require a license, and so that's why we said it was optional, but it certainly provides a much faster lookup for the person. And if people didn't want to show their license, we just ask them for their name, and it's an alphabetical lookup, or we can look them up by address.
It's certainly going to be faster than scanning through the papers.
It is.
Do we have
it
any
is.
Sort of a firewall that protects the information?
What?
Well, I don't care if it goes out on the web or not. It's obvious, you know, it doesn't make any difference. If you have two iPads talking to each other, the information is out there if somebody wants.
I would hope that the mechanism and the software firm or whatever they put into the unit is encrypted, but I don't know.
Yes, it is. It is. We've been assured of that.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Ms. Deal?
Yes, there's two things. First of all, in the past, it's funny how easily we forget, when we would sign in the town meeting, did you have four
checkers?
Checkers,
yes.
Yeah, you did.
Because we had four, we did
well,
it by precinct.
Precinct.
We
precinct.
Had to do it by
okay.
precinct.
Okay, and this, you didn't have to do that.
Correct.
Because everything's
all in one.
In one.
Yeah.
And I guess that maybe, in some respects, as much as it sped things up, it, in some respects, it also slowed things down a little bit because there was only two lines. You know?
Yes, in a way. But I think really, as I said, it was more of a result of everybody walking
come
in at,
the last
at 7 o'clock.
I don't doubt that.
I
don't doubt
yeah.
that. And the other thing is, in looking at your budget, with regard to early voting, do you have a number on the cost?
Well, I don't have early voting in this budget because there will be no election that incorporates early voting.
And that's only in the presidential, is that right?
Only in the state election. So every November, whether it's the governor's race or the presidential race, every other year on an even year when we have a state election in November. So that would be in 2019.
Yeah,
because we'd have a a November governor's race then. That's a state election.
And okay, so that's not it now.
And it is mandated under the current law that early voting will occur for every state election. So every other year in November, that's when we would have early voting.
Okay. I guess I'm curious to know if you happen to know off the top of your head what the cost for early voting was. I don't recall seeing it.
I thought somebody might ask.
It's there were heavy crowd, you know.
The Division of Local Mandates, you know, did look at this matter, and they did, you know, they sent out a survey to get our feedback and to get our costs from the municipalities, and they did determine that certain specific costs were in fact unfunded mandates, and hope that the state will come through for payment. In anticipation of early voting, you know, because we knew when the law had passed, we knew when it was going to take place. In my current year budget, which encompassed the early voting from November, I did have money in there, I don't know if you recall, from my budget in anticipation. It wasn't, you know, as much money as early voting cost, but it certainly made a big dent in it because I kind of forecast what we needed for election workers and things like that. But the total mandated costs for North Reading that would be considered unfunded mandates came to about $6,600. And that was for personnel costs, which would be the election workers and any staffing time from my office, and any supplies that were necessary to carry out early voting, which was, if you recall, the portable tabletop voting booths that I did purchase for use in room 5 to allow for privacy for every voter. Other voting booths I had already in stock here that we use normally for absentee voting, so those were already on hand. Some communities had to buy voting booths. Other costs that we had that were considered optional costs were police details, which I used for the Saturday when we did early voting, as well as the two evenings when we did early voting. I did not utilize police details during normal working hours. And the newspaper ads, oddly, we were required to put notification in the newspaper under the law, but they did not require that it be a paid ad. But the only way to ensure that your notice was in the paper on the proper dates in relation to what the law specified was to make sure you put in a paid ad. So just to be certain, you know, right, we paid for the ads, you know, which I normally pay for some sort of advertising anyways for election costs. So optional costs that they determined would have then been $4,500, including the cost for the poll pads, let's say. That does not cover other incidentals of things that we needed to effectively carry out, markers, envelope sealers. There were a host of just minor little things from W.B. Mason or right, places like that, containers bought at Walmart to put the ballot envelopes to store them till they got locked in the safe. Incidentals that I don't have a number for right now.
But the cost for the iPads are not included in this?
Not, they were not considered mandated costs under the law, under the
So that was an optional cost?
Yes.
And that's included in the 45?
That's included in the 45.
No, I understand. I just want to understand.
That's included in the 45.
The number, so your total cost is about 11,000.
1,500 for other incidentals, the police. Okay. Details and newspaper ads, maybe another $500 on top of that, so let's say 2,000, because I did some other signage to post on the doors here at Town Hall to say early voting here. I had an A-frame sign that was like $200, and other signs for the windows for handicap entrances to make sure that handicap voters would come in the proper entrance.
So your total cost to the town?
You know, Mr. Yule, I'd have to go back, but let's put that at about $11,500 total for the whole early voting process, roughly. I'd say that's a good figure.
And it's direct cost to the town because you're 6,600 mandated but unfunded,
right,
and then everything else. So
I will say that the state, Secretary of State's office, did give us offer an incentive to communities if they would be open for at least 4 hours on the one Saturday during those 2 weeks, and they paid us $1,000 to do that, which we didn't expect. We would have been open nevertheless, but that was a nice bonus.
So I would take $1,000 off that total cost.
Yeah, I'm not sure if that would carry through in future early voting cycles.
Well, they're so generous,
but it was really to try to promote communities to offer at least one weekend day. And
the state cost you $11,500, and they were so nice to give us $1,000. Okay. Well, I'm going to ask one final question with regard to your office, and this might be it here, actually, as I asked everybody else. I mean, what do you need in dollars and cents to help you be more effective on what you do?
Should I throw out the new building?
Everybody wants
yes.
buildings. The library.
Gotta do it. I've been here too long. Definitely a new building. Definitely a new vault. The vault is vault.
Vault.
Our vault for storage is in need of attention. You know, I mean, whether it's you know, expanding it, or allowing, you know, the ability to somehow reconfigure it. You know, there's tracking available for vaults where you can have movable shelving systems to make your records, you know, you could store more records but have them, you know, available to you. Document management throughout the town where we have, you know, workflows that go from department to department.
Are you okay with all the software that you have? I mean, you don't need any improved software or something like that?
I have software that we're, well, I will tell you that in the horizon now, we just did, there is a new public records law that has recently passed, and that is probably going to become more burdensome for communities and departments. It already has for some. I know Liz gets a lot of requests for information. The public realizes that we are now put in the position where we have to provide more information. We're under really bigger time constraints to do so, and we have to provide it at a lesser cost than, if not, you know, almost free sometimes to anybody who is seeking certain information. So, to effectively carry out the new program or the new law, you know, to its best abilities, we may need some software tracking program for public records. Now, this law just came into effect on January 1, and it isn't going to be fully implemented in cities and towns till really July 1. I think we'll get a better taste of what's coming our ways once that hits. And we'll have to see how well we can monitor requests and deadlines to make sure we're in compliance with the law so we don't incur any penalties or fees, and have some kind of perhaps some tracking software for requests that is out there and available to all departments, you know, so it would be basically cloud-based.
So if I understood you correctly, you're talking 2018, July 1.
Yes,
correct.
This coming year.
So there could be some hidden costs coming up your way that you would not be prepared to handle if it was significant.
If it was significant, you know. Yes.
And whatever that is, I don't know what that number
is. I don't think any of us do at this
but,
point. Yeah.
But, okay.
So, Jeff, there is, you know, we've had discussions and there is need for a complete document system.
Right.
There's a need to try to get something that is either compatible with interfaces with Munis or something that Munis will provide directly, and that all town documents eventually going to have to end up there. So it's not in the capital plan for this current fiscal year, but I've had discussions with the town administrator regarding year from now, we have a new IT director, and that's going to be one of his hot topics to deal with. There's visibility of it. We're probably not going to be ahead of the game, but we're going to be close, I would think. Hi, Michael.
Hopefully it's a quick question. So we have four precincts, and I assume that's determined by either, is it number of residents or number of registered voters?
Residents.
And
it's based on the federal census every 10 years.
Are we getting to a point with the growth in our town that we're going to have a fifth precinct?
It could be. It could be. We are at 15, five right now. So we have four precincts. Once we hit 16,000 residents, that could trigger a fifth precinct.
And is there a cost associated with having a fifth precinct?
Well, there would be a cost as far as elections. You know, when we run elections, we would have to staff five precincts instead of four, you know, things like that. There's no cost per se that there's five precincts in our town, and, you know, that in itself triggers an extra cost.
Okay, so the location we do the voting at now can handle a fifth precinct?
That would be a discussion with the church, because it certainly, we could not accommodate another precinct in the parish hall, in the church hall, where we right now have four precincts. But there are classrooms down the hallway, whether, I know that there is some that can be joined, two rooms can be joined, because there's a wall that can come down, you know, a sliding wall. But that's a discussion, you know, to be had with the church.
Okay. Just wanted to know. Thank you.
Mr. O'Leary.
What about early voting for local elections?
It's not in the law yet. It's not an option on the local level.
It's not an option?
No, it's not. It's one of these things that, you know, the Pandora's box has been opened now. Is it something that the voters are going to be pressuring their legislators for all elections, you know, primaries, local elections, special elections, state elections?
What do we have, about 20% of the participants? 22% or something?
We had about 35%. Yes, 35%.
35%, but the overall turnout was about the same as the previous presidential election.
It was actually a little lower.
Right.
It was actually a little lower.
Percentage-wise or number-wise, or both?
Percentage-wise. I couldn't tell you the numbers. Yes. It would, you know, of course, the number of registered voters increased from 4 years ago.
Right.
But percentage-wise, it was a couple of percentage points lower than the 4 years previous for turnout. I think that's more of a reflection of perhaps the candidates, and maybe people weren't sure who they wanted to vote for than anything.
No, but I mean, I talked with a lot of people that participated and really enjoyed the opportunity.
Yes.
To vote early. So.
Yes, they did. They did. Yeah. But the law doesn't allow for anything other than state elections at this point. It isn't a local option.
Okay. But you would think that with early voting, that you would get more total participation.
Well, the opportunity.
You would help. I mean, otherwise.
I know, but it, to the point that was just made, it didn't necessarily happen, but it was still, the opportunity was far greater for people to participate, you know, as a convenience to their schedule rather than at one day. So, it's a good idea.
And Mr. Chair, you know, on that, the only thing. It made it a little bit more convenient for some voters, but really all it did was add $11,000 to our cost. That's really all it did. You could have done the same thing in one day, but it saved $11,000.
Right, I think.
That's good. I was just
what
asking.
What other questions do we have? We've got still.
Before we get off of early voting, I just have to.
And we
throw
are running, running the clock to the point where.
I would just like to throw out a huge compliment to my staff and to the election workers who handled early voting, because it was something brand new, and they took it on like champs and ran with it. They enjoyed it thoroughly. They were so helpful to the voters. Everybody had a great experience throughout early voting, and I have to just compliment my election workers who did it, they just did a phenomenal job. They really did, and they looked forward to it. It was very exciting, I will say that. It was a very exciting opportunity. I didn't participate in early voting. I'm still a stickler for election day voting, but I think having the opportunity there for people who wanted to participate is what it's all about, you know, to encourage people to come and vote. So we were happy to do it, and it was like Groundhog Day. You know, you woke up in the morning, it was another election. You woke up in the morning, and it was another election. So it was very interesting. It was very well received, and as I said, it could not have worked out better here in North Reading. And I credit the people that helped do it, because they did a marvelous job.
They did.
Thank you.
Any other questions for Barbara? Thank you, Barbara.
Thank you, folks.
Treasurer and collector, Mary Ann.
Good evening.
Hello.
So, Mary McKay, the treasurer collector. My office handles real estate, personal property, motor vehicle, trash, water, sending out all the bills and collecting all the bills.
Excuse me, can you speak into the mic? I apologize. We can't hear you on this side.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Oh, wait.
Sorry.
I can't hear you. None of us can hear you.
Okay.
Sorry. It's
sorry.
Loud because of the heat.
So, I'm going to shut it off?
I don't need it, but I don't want to make anyone uncomfortable, but it would be nice if we could turn it off for just a few minutes.
Looks like somebody's got the scarf on. And
oh, much better.
Okay. Do you want me to start over?
No.
Okay.
Keep going.
So my budget for the treasurer's office, the only thing that's in that budget is salaries. Everything else is over in the collector's budget, and that budget only went up $2,500 due to postage and just some supplies that I need for the new printers that we received. The ribbons are a lot more expensive than our old ribbons, and we have three of those now, and they actually imprint on the back of the checks for the customers that come in, so we use them a lot.
Questions regarding treasury?
Yes, that has my assistant Maureen's her salary in there and my stipend in there. That's the only thing that's in my treasury budget.
Any questions on treasury? Now you move on to collection.
Okay. So on my collection budget, UNIS training is coming to Boston next year. So we did put in some money for myself and my staff to go to that conference. So that's why there was a increase in the budget for the training for us to attend that conference, because it doesn't usually come in Boston. So and then on the postage, it's to mail out the motor vehicle, the real estate, personal property, the W-2s, the 1099s, the 1095s. We get bills that come back, we have to resend them out. So it's just the volume of mm-hmm. items being sent out.
Michael.
Is there an option to elect to have email bills sent out?
We're working on that with the technology today. We are getting more requests for that, so that is something we are working on. Hopefully by FY19, we will have something in place that people can opt to have their bills emailed.
That'd be great. Thanks.
You're welcome.
How's the participation as far as paying online?
We have a tremendous amount of people that do pay on our website. We have it on our bills that they can pay online, and we have it on our website. When they call in to make a payment, we do tell them that they can pay their bills online, and all the information is there. So when they do go online to pay, they can see the payments that they have made, all their history. If they go through our website, it's actually live data, so as soon as it gets posted, as soon as they make the payment, it shows it right on their account. Well, it's the next day because we have to upload the file, but it's live data. So if they make a payment today, they can go online tomorrow and actually see the payment has been posted to their account. So it's been very beneficial, especially like tax time, like right now. You can find out, you know, how much you paid in taxes. You can go right on the website and find out how much you paid for taxes. And it gives you, when we converted over, we had all the history converted over, so they can see the history from 2000, I believe it was 2000, to current, all their payments, all their valuations, everything is right online.
Now, do they have to have a special a bill number in order to access their record, or can they access his records?
No, we do, because of privacy, we do actually have that. In real estate, I believe you do need the bill number and maybe the map and parcel. Or the map and parcel to actually get into your bill, just so you can't, like you know, Mr. Messeri can't look up your bill, or you can't look up his bill. We make it a little bit difficult for the customer, for the homeowner, to look up their neighbor's bills. They can come in and look at the assessor's information and find out that information, but we don't allow that online.
I do a lot of people's taxes, and they could use that information, but I can't get at it, so it's...
If you have the map and parcel, anybody can get in. So if you have a copy of their bill, you can go right on the website and pull up the information, as long as you have their map and parcel.
And the bill number?
Not for real estate, you don't need...
For real estate.
But the motor vehicle bill, you do need your bill number.
Roughly what percentage of people use that versus either coming in paying, sending a check, or having a bank check sent from the bank account?
We still have a lot of people that are using their online banking, so we are receiving checks from their online banking. But I don't know the percentage. I know there's a lot more people using it because I can see the numbers, you know, the money going into the bank. I can see those numbers, but I'm not sure off the top of my head. I could find out and get back to you.
I asked a question because I could, through my bank, pay the bill, and it wouldn't cost me anything.
Correct, but
I pay through the town website, so I pay the 25 cents.
Correct.
And, you know, it's good that the water and the trash get combined because it's only 1.25 cents.
Correct.
But is there something we do about that that might act as an incentive and it would make it easier for you? Because I understand when you get payments, like if you got a payment from my bank directly, you have to go running around trying to figure out what it's for.
Correct, because they physically, a lot of people think when they pay through their bank that they wire the money to us or ACH the money to us and it directly gets put into our account. They physically send checks to us. So if you're paying your account and you put your bill number as 5, but that was last year's bill number, because usually the bill numbers change for motor vehicle.
Right.
So we have to look up, okay, you're saying that you're paying, you know, a Toyota, and we pull up bill number 5 and it's not your name, it's not a Toyota. So we do have to do some research on it. So it's more time-consuming when people actually mail their checks in from their banks to us. Now, if they just went on our website and did it, it would automatically get posted up to their account.
Liz.
So in order for us to get rid of the 25-cent fee, we could budget for it. We could absorb that cost. It would just be an added bank charge. A lot of communities do that. They're mainly cities, but there are communities that do pay it for the residents.
I guess you'd have to look at the potential savings there.
We'd have to do some analysis.
And that may not necessarily attract those people that are using the bank to make a change anyway.
Mr. Chair?
Mr. Yu.
Yes. I think we instituted the fee about 7 years ago, 8 years ago, something like that. I think we were on the board. I think that was obviously when Greg Balikonis was here.
I don't ever recall.
I recall us voting
a discussion.
On it.
It was actually the bank that initiated the fee for, it was the bank. It wasn't us that initiated the fee. I think what you might be thinking of, Jeff, is the demand fee. It was probably about 8 years ago. We went up on the demand fee from $5 to $30.
Thank you for correcting me.
But isn't it the vendor that's getting the 10, 25 cents?
Yes, it is.
Yeah.
So it's, yeah.
That's what she said, you gotta put it in the budget to pay for.
I did have another question, Mr. Chair.
Jeff, go ahead.
I think I ask this every year, scheduled payment.
Yes.
When can we do that?
The bank, they say that they're upgrading their system for us to be able to do that. We're still waiting for them to do that. We might be looking into another online system that would be able to do that. Hopefully for FY19, it will be in place, but
and
as of right.
Is a different service than you're using now?
It would still be, all the money gets deposited into Unibank, but it would be a different service that you actually go on to and be linked to our Munis, correct.
It's been over a year.
Yes, it has been, correct. And they keep telling us that, yep, you know, it's in the stages, we're working on it, and we haven't seen anything yet.
I know.
We did meet with the other company back in August around the time that the IT director was in the hospital, and so nothing has happened at this time because it requires some IT help, and our IT director just started March 1st, so we're working on it. And that's not just an excuse.
Other questions for Marianne?
Other than the trash, it's not clear which bills to the town you could actually program to automatically pay. In other words, tax bill could vary, the water bill varies. The only one that's a constant is the trash bill, which I would just assume, right? You check for the whole year.
You can do that. When you first get your trash bill at the beginning of the year, you can pay the full amount for the whole year. That's the taxpayer's option if they want to do that.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Other questions for Marianne?
No, thank you.
Thank you.
All right, thank you.
I think we have the assessor next.
Good evening, guys. Thank you for holding the budget hearing. Debbie Carboni, assessing manager. My budget didn't change drastically. I did move a few things around. I took out the personal property maintenance, which is our software maintenance, and put that down in subscription and dues. So that changed a little bit. Professional services, we did increase that. What the increase of $3,077 is due to the mandated state program of the cyclical cycle. We are on track with that, and that's a directive from the Bureau of Local Assessment that we do a third of the town every 3 years, so that in our ninth year of cycle, being a reval year, we would be in compliance with the number of parcels that has been remeasured and relisted. So I would like to say our office is up to date on that by putting it in the budget as opposed to going out to an RFP. The dues and subscriptions, we're probably going to spend a little more time on this because FY19 we're going to be talking a little bit different than this year. The state CAMA, as I reported last year, has discontinued their appraisal product. They've basically taken us off life support, forcing us to find another vendor. We have done that. we have chosen to go with Tyler IAS, which right now we have signed an MUE, which commits us as one of 40 property municipalities to sign on with them. I'm excited about the product. There are other vendors out there that, you know, towns do use that are, you know, commonly used. Tyler is very new to our assessing world. But I did get an opportunity to go to the city of Peabody, and the assessor there graciously granted me a half a day, and we went through a lot of the elements of the product that I use on a daily basis. So starting April of next year, the conversion will be done. What that says is our subscription or our support fee for Tyler IAS, currently we're paying $4,475. That support fee will increase to $8,710. Now, they have told me that the reason Tyler was offering this low support fee was because they're not very well known in the state. They are very well known in the South, Atlanta, South Carolina. With that being said, they're not charging us a conversion fee. Call that what you may, is it built into the double fee of the subscription? That's what I look at. The typical conversion fee from the other vendors was around anywhere between $5,500 to $6,500. So we would have to pay that the one time, and then their support fee is definitely lower than the Tyler. At the end of the day, you know, I looked at the products and I looked at the cost, and this, we have to have an appraisal system, and I'm excited about using this new system. I do think that as CAMA support is now delinquent, it's gone, we will see more of Tyler coming around to the state of Massachusetts. My biggest concern was their support for issues and as we converted our data. I have been reassured that their support is phenomenal. We do use Tyler for Munis for our real estate tax file. They are not related in any way. They're two different entities. So I have asked my support guys from Munis, and they don't know anything about it. I was hoping to get some kind of insight with that. The GIS mapping, I like to report for the third year in a row, we're up to date on our maps. We're in compliance with the Department of Revenue, and it's a beautiful system. I'm very happy working with AppGeo. They do a great job for us, and they're very timely. Our maps for FY18 are currently in there as we speak. That's all I really have for an update in the assessing budget. Are there any questions?
I'm trying to sort out, so this is all under the professional services budget?
The
you're just
under
talking
the,
about, or is it broken into two pieces?
No, under the professional services, Bob, you're not going to see that 8710 this year. You're going to see the 4,475. So my CSC or my state CAMA will remain the same for FY18. I was saying, alluding to FY19, just so that I'm keeping everybody in the loop, that next year we will be seeing a big difference in that line item.
And what line item is that?
The professional services.
Okay, it's in there, okay.
Yeah, and it's also, I have it in the description too. I just didn't want to get up here next year this time and it's, you know, have to
explain. You're assuming we're going to remember what you said.
I think I mentioned it last year too, knowing that it was on its way.
Mr. Yule.
Yes, thank you. Right now we're paying $45.75.
Correct.
All right. Next year with Tyler.
FY19.
FY19. We'll be paying $87.10.
That's correct.
For as a maintenance fee, but we're not paying a conversion fee.
Correct.
All right. Is it going to be $87.10 in FY20?
Hold on, I have that.
Just like unit support costs, they go up typically 5% annually. So I believe that for FY19. The cost for this Tyler product will be part of the IT budget, and you know we can anticipate a 5% increase each year after that.
Okay, so then I guess the next question I have is, unless I missed it, do we know what the normal maintenance fee is out there with other programs, or is this so godly good that?
The Tyler IAS for their maintenance support fee is about $2,000 more than what I was finding with the other vendors, $18,000 to $2,000. I didn't bring the other vendors in with me. So I do have FY19, $87.10 through FY21. In fiscal year 22, it goes up to $9,058. Fiscal 23, $9,421. Fiscal 24, $9,798. And 25 is $10,189.
Well, I guess what I'm trying to straighten out in my head is that, I mean, the jump is significant. I mean,
yes.
Okay. And to your point earlier about whether they are, they're not charging us a
conversion fee,
but they really are charging us a conversion fee. If you just look at the numbers, okay?
Right.
But the fact that and they're not charging us, is it better to have them charge us a conversion fee and then pay $45,000?
It's
not.
I'm
trying to get to that.
Right, right. And I can probably. Make sense out of that. At the end of the day, anytime you have any kind of database and you have a conversion, you typically would pay the conversion fee, and then you're still going to pay the support fee.
Right.
And as Liz alluded to, there's always an increase in your support. So because I'm saying that, yes, we're going to be paying double, we also have to remember that the state CAMA was always a lot lower than if you went to Vision or Patriot, which are your big vendors and most commonly known. So state CAMA was always about $2,000 less than state than the Vision and the Patriots. So Tyler IAS is actually in line with them. You see what I'm saying?
I understand what you're saying. I'm not sure if
I'm quite
agreeing with that. When you keep going out the years, assuming just for argument's sake that the cost, the normal cost, is around $6,000, and the current people that we use were less than $5,000. All right. So and Tyler is going to be approximately $2,000 more. Eventually, Tyler's going to stay higher than all the others that are charging 6,000 versus now. Eventually, we're going to be paying more than for this product down the road. Now, if it's a great product and it works, if it's effective, that's most important.
There's also another part of that. Tyler IAS is cloud-based, whereas your other vendors are not cloud-based. With that being said, now we're taking off the table that our current hardware and equipment is not going to have to be replaced. We do have one computer that we use for the vendor that will need to be replaced, but that's one, that's not four.
Right, and that's also not the servers.
Okay. The servers.
I'm getting the feeling I don't have a complete picture of what the savings are here at this moment, but if I just look at the numbers and everything remains the same, then to me it looks like we're going to be spending more money in the future. But if there are other aspects to this that I don't know, then I can't make.
And we don't know the fee agreements for, Patriot or Vision, the competitors. They could have an escalated scale. They also could, redevelop their product and then put that back on the user, meaning the cost of that redevelopment, expanding their product. So we can't predict that. But, there are added costs that those products would cost us. So we would have to buy a new server. We'd have to buy some new computers. With the Tyler product, we don't need to do that.
Thank you.
And this is a necessity. So.
The vendors are always going to stay competitive. So what I'm saying is I don't think at the end of the day Tyler is going to end up more expensive than the other two vendors. They're going to end up competitive one way or the other. We're still going to be saving on the implementation where we're not going to have to purchase all the new equipment and hardware and servers and find room for servers that we would have to go in with another vendor.
Did you already purchase this?
No. No. We've signed the MUE, which means that is a commitment that the town is saying this is who we're going with. We're not contracted with them as yet. The state has not even come out with the contract. As of last week, they're still working on the language for the contract, according to Mass IT.
Thank you.
Does anyone else have any questions? I think you still have another question.
I'm concerned that I
want to get IT in.
I do have questions. But I can always sit down with Liz and she can.
I don't have a question, but in terms of the process, based on the hour, my request respectfully submitted would be we take information technology and then try to also address human resources. And Ms. Rourke and I will be here on April 3rd for the next meeting. We could take up finance and accounting and administrative budgets on that night.
So you're suggesting that before the public hearing we do those two?
Yes, if possible.
And we'll delay the public hearing then.
That'll put you on time.
Let's go.
Not as great we've been going.
Thank you.
IT is next. Thank you.
Sorry, I have a lot of questions.
Hi, folks. It should be short and sweet.
Welcome to the fire.
Oh, pardon?
Welcome to the fire.
Not a problem. So,
welcome to town.
Now, sadly, I was a little bit late to the party, so a lot of the figuring and the commitments and whatnot were done before I got to come on board. But I understand we are asking for a little bit more than we did last year, and there's probably going to be some questions about that. So, if you'd like, fire away.
Why don't you start with what it is that you think you're adding to the...
Oh, not a problem. So,
what are the highlights?
Well, right now, we're currently requesting a hair over 200,185, which is a bit of a bump up from last year's 174,303. Oh, I'm sorry, my totals. Wrong line. First time looking at the sheet. Thank you. No. We're actually looking in total. Thank you for this year. We're looking for 42,885, and that is a bump up from 443,342.
And just to speak about the personal services line item, at October town meeting, we did cut this line item. We reduced it from some savings, so there was a revised budget figure. And also, we needed to increase the salary of the IT director, and we still have the position of the GIS coordinator. So there's three positions within the IT budget: the director, the assistant, or software technician, computer technician, and then the GIS coordinator position,
which is not filled at this point.
Correct.
Okay.
That will be our next homework assignment, is to re-advertise for that position.
And what's the capital request for IT?
The capital request for IT is just the annual computer replacement plan. Mm-hmm.
Nothing else.
There is nothing else, no, not this year, but there are lots of things that, are coming down the pipeline for IT.
What has become of the Comcast issue with the INET?
That is still an issue, and the Cable Advisory Committee is negotiating with Comcast.
Okay, so there's nothing in the proposed budget?
No.
To deal with that if it blows up on us at this point.
We don't know what the outcome of that will be. So.
Mm-hmm. Okay. I'm sorry, go ahead.
No, not a problem. No.
Abby's got a question.
Abby, go ahead.
Well, the Capital Committee is seriously considering and will probably fund the phase one of the police and fire communications.
A phase one of what?
Police and fire communications.
Yes, that's not the same thing.
Lead into something that could replace Comcast if it dies.
Okay.
I'm sorry, I didn't catch part of the audio, didn't make it over here. I believe the question was something, what do we do if the Comcast fiber dies? Was that the question?
I don't believe it was a question.
No, it was more. I think Abby was making a comment that there's something that was already in the works that may address some of the Comcast issue.
Yes.
I'm not sure that the first phase addresses the Comcast issue.
It would be the second phase
that would address the Comcast issue with the fiber.
But without the first phase, you can't have the second phase.
Well, we can do a phase without. We have to do the communications now, but we could have done fiber without even involving police or fire communication.
That's true.
So more to come on that.
All right, so obviously you haven't been on board for a very long time. So.
Nope, just coming up on 2 weeks.
So
wait to the party.
In the 2 weeks that you've been here, have you flagged anything that we should be, and it may not be in this budget, but.
Well, it may not show up explicitly as such, but part of the increase in cost is going to be replacing an aging fleet of hardware and systems that we've got.
Yeah, but you're talking about the capital that's already requested, right? Or are we talking about
this
something?
This is separate.
What?
This is a separate. There's a lot of expiring. Are you speaking about the expiring warranty?
Yeah. Well, we've got a lot of devices that are falling out of their supportable warranty period.
Mm-hmm.
Trying to extend it makes it not worth the effort. So we have to start looking into either extending warranties where we can, where it's still cost effective, and replacing hardware where trying to extend the warranty is either not cost effective or puts us in an unsupportable position.
Mm-hmm.
Where theoretically we could run without computers. I don't think anyone would want to.
Well, you might be able to run without warranties, though.
Except if something bad happens, then that puts us in if it's in a position where the device is unsupportable, that puts us with our hands tied. We'll have a device that doesn't work, and we might be able to cobble something together, but that doesn't give us any guarantee it'll continue to function.
I would assume that you have some hot spares. Yes? No?
Some of the warranties are on servers, Bob, so...
Oh, well, that's different.
Yeah.
Okay,
yeah.
I misunderstood.
Yeah.
But no, mission-critical appliance, like, for example, the firewall, the VPN server, the spam filter, these devices are coming on, they're getting long in the tooth stage. They're good for a little bit longer, but they will require replacing in the next fiscal year.
Okay.
or this upcoming one, I should say.
I misunderstood.
We do have spare computers, though, mm-hmm. you know, that we can deploy.
If a computer blows up or something.
Exactly. Yeah. So that is not.
Is there a potential for further requests in October?
I don't see it. I think that we can manage until June. But, you know, if there is something big that happens, then we might need to. But I wouldn't try to do it outside the capital process.
And you don't see a need necessarily to augment the reserve fund for the Finance Committee to have funds available? Just in case.
Not at this time. No.
Anything else?
I just want to give Abby a few more fun, you know, dollars to work with. Yeah,
not even
good.
Anything else in your 2 weeks here that?
Nothing. Nothing that's out. That's earth-shatteringly crisis level. A lot of initiatives from the last year need to be carried through and brought to completion. But those are now back on track and moving along. We're looking to, the goal is using existing funds, make all those devices in front of you no more mystical or important than a stapler. So that if there's a problem, all you have to do is pop a new one on your desk and you're good to go. There'll be no downtime, no moving in, no getting reacquainted with the system. You'll simply log in and within a matter of moments, everything you need will be right in front of you, just like it was on your last system.
Anyone else have any questions regarding IT? I guess we're letting you off easy tonight.
Oh, no worries. We'll be talking more, I'm sure.
Yes.
Thank you.
Welcome to town.
Yes. I'm glad to have you. All right. One other budget was?
Human resources,
right. Now I
got to
go find out what that one is.
Good evening, Bob Collins, Human Resources Director. Compared to my colleague, Mr. Cooper, I guess I am a bit of a veteran, having a little over 2 months under my belt now. Our budget, the largest increase relates to myself, my new role. We also request an additional amount for training. I think up until this point, the HR department or the HR function hasn't had an opportunity to keep up with the current laws and the trends. And in terms of dues and memberships, one of the things we're looking at is the Society for Human Resource Management, or SHRM, in addition to valuable training and access to other colleagues in the human resource world. One of the things we're looking at is shifting over our current testing that we do for clerical positions. And I had sent something out through the MMPA as to what would be the most effective way to handle that. And the majority communities don't do that. So it's a good thing that we actually are doing that we're, you know, providing objective standards and training in addition to testing, but that SHRM provides the best bang for the buck.
Any questions? I guess I'll start. Do we have a personnel manual?
No, we do not. Currently, the way we do it is we have a series of policies. We also have it through the majority of our employees are covered under collective bargaining agreements. What you end up doing with that under General Laws Chapter 150E is you could, in theory, come up with a personnel manual, but any of the terms and conditions would be overridden by the collective bargaining agreements. And to the extent that you wish to change something that was either a practice or something under the CBA, you'd have to bargain over it. That would leave the remaining employees that you could develop through a personnel manual.
I bring it up because most people that deal with IT and administration understand what's going on out in the world. And security is becoming, to maintain decent security is becoming more and more difficult. And it seems to me that, and I've run into, you know, I'm in the business, and I've run into it some of our customers where, they are not paying a lot of attention to what their employees are doing when they shouldn't be doing it. And a lot of that could be resolved with an appropriate employee manual that spells out the rules. Now, I understand the union issue, but it seems to me that union or not, some of these rules should be applied across the board.
Yes, well, along that line, typically what you'd see is, in addition to having a personnel manual, you have a reasonable use policy or a separate manual dealing with IT functions in general. And I would coordinate with Mr. Cooper in that. We've actually discussed cobbling, putting something together on those lines. As he gets more settled in, I was going to draw upon him as well in terms of developing a policy along that for, obviously, your approval.
Well, I just think it's something we ought to put some time and thought into.
I agree.
And, you know, if there's an impact on the budget, you know, maybe you ought to think that through before we lock everything down. Any other comments, questions? Nobody?
I'll just make a comment. I've had the opportunity to work with Mr. Collins now on the health care and a few other things, and I got to say you are a wonderful addition to the town. I want to thank you, and I think the money in the budget is being well spent having your services, so thank you for joining our team.
Thank you very much. It's a pleasure working here.
And we're glad you're here.
Thank you.
Do you have any other comments, sir?
No, I have to say I'm very impressed with the level of professionalism and the level of commitment of not only the town hall employees, but all the employees that I've encountered and their willingness to give their, you know, as much as they do and the way they do. I also respect the way that the town is a very good steward of the taxpayers' dollar and takes a very hard look at everything we spend, and hopefully we continue to do that. And also, you know, from an HR perspective, you know, we're not Ford Motor Company. We're not making so much a tangible product, but we're providing a service to the residents of the community. And that service is provided by our people. And to the extent that, and I want to give a shout out to Allison, our benefits coordinator, that we in the personnel department can help our department heads, our employees, and our residents in terms of, you know, helping to deliver the best quality service at the most economical price. That's what we're here to do.
Any other questions for Bob? Well, thank you.
Thank you.
So, Michael, that leaves us with finance and accounting and administration. And your suggestion is to do that?
We'd add them to the April 3rd meeting, which
add
is when
the April meeting?
Which is when the balance of the budgets will be heard.
Mr. O'Leary?
Sounds good to me.
Charge of the April meeting.
Okay.
Okay. Next item on our agenda, then, we have a public hearing, and I will set forth to read the notice of public hearing, and then we'll get underway. In accordance with Chapter 138 of the Massachusetts General Laws, a public hearing will be held by the Board of Selectmen in Room 14, Town Hall, 235 North Street, on Monday, March 20th, 2017, at 9:15 p.m. on the application of Smokes and Snacks, Inc., DBA Route 28 Lucky Mart, for the transfer of the package store wine and malt alcohol beverage license to be exercised at 202 North Street, North Reading, Massachusetts, occupying 2,684 total square feet. This has been called by the Board of Selectmen. Well, the public hearing is now open. We'll wait a few seconds for the meeting hall to reorganize itself. And everybody goes. We have a board member, Mr. Yule, who stepped out for a minute, so we'll wait until he returns.
Thank you.
We should just get started, Mr. Misery. The evening's getting late. Can we get started?
Sit down. Sir?
Okay.
Name and address and...
Mr. Chair, members of the board, Attorney Tom Truax of Salem, Massachusetts, appearing here on behalf of the proposed transferee, Smokes and Snacks, Inc., DBA Route 28, Lucky Mart. I'll introduce who's with me today. To my immediate left here is Sonal Patel. She's the proposed license manager. Next to her is Ricky Patel. He's one of the employees at the store. Next to Ricky is Mr. Ketan Patel. He is also one of the employees of the store. He's also the son of the president and owner of the store, Mr. Atran Patel, who's on my farthest to my left. Okay. So these are pretty much the major players in the corporation that are involved here.
Okay.
Before you is a application for a transfer of license from Pendleton Ventures, Inc. to Smokes and Snacks, Inc. Here tonight is Mr. Pendleton. He is the owner of Pendleton Ventures, Inc., the current licensee. Also with us tonight is the landlord of the premises. The transaction, underlying transaction, is contained in the purchase and sale agreement, a copy of which was included in the package. Essentially, it's a transfer of the liquor license from the current licensee, which is Pendleton Ventures, Inc., to the new corporation, Smokes and Snacks, Inc. I'd like to tell you a little bit about Lucky Mart, first of all. It has been in operation since October 1st, 2016. The lease begins on October 1st, 2016, and that's when it began to operate there. As I said, there's a copy, the landlord is here, and a copy of the lease is included in your package. Of particular importance in the lease is the use provision, which is contained in section 1.16 of the lease. Because of a restriction in the deed to the transfer to the landlord, a quote, convenience store like 7-Eleven, unquote, cannot operate at that location. Therefore, when you read the section 1.16 of the lease, you'll see that the permitted use is defined there, and it's defined as, quote, lottery, tobacco products, bait, beer and wine, with other products incidental thereto, such as beverages including soda, coffee, slush and snacks, including chips, ice cream, propane, and pharmacy products. Tenants shall not operate a convenience store whose primary business is selling either food for consumption off the seller's premises alone or in combination with grocery items or other non-durable items found in the supermarket, unquote. Now, Mr. Patel and the landlord worked very hard at the inception of this lease to make sure that they weren't in violation of the restrictive covenant found in the deed. As a result, Mr. Patel has a store that sells just what the lease provides for, tobacco products, there's a humidor for the cigars, snacks, candy, drinks, pharmacy items, pet food, household goods, there's some car products, some motor oil, some minor things like that, and lottery products. Now they're appearing before you here because they have a desire to sell beer and wine at the store. The NCAS, the National Convenience Store Association, has defined a convenience store as follows. It's a store, that retail store, that offers a products mix which includes dairy, bakery, snack foods, beverages, tobacco, grocery, health and beauty aids, confectionery, prepared foods to go, fresh or frozen meats, sometimes gasoline, sometimes services such as Western Union, and limited produce items. I have taken some very quick pictures. I know, I believe a few of you have been into the store, but just in case for other benefit of the other members, just like some quick snapshots of what the inside of the store looks like. (Clears throat) Mr. Patel's store is clearly not a convenience store. He sells no dairy. He sells no grocery items. He sells no produce. He sells no meat or no prepared foods. And right now, the store sales break down roughly as follows. Approximately 33% is lottery. Approximately 43% is tobacco products, including cigars. And approximately 24% is snacks, candy, drinks, pharmacy items, pet foods, household goods, and the other miscellaneous items. With the addition of the beer and wine, they project that beer and wine sales to eventually comprise approximately 20 to 25% of store sales. As for experience, Mr. Atmaran Patel, he comes before you owning ownership interests in two liquor licenses already. He has experience owning a liquor store in Worcester and in Pepperell, both full liquor stores. So he is very familiar with the beer and wine component of a package store. He also owns a smoke shop in Peabody called Peabody Smoke Shop. So he's also very familiar with the tobacco component of this store. Now Ms. Patel, the proposed license manager, is also familiar with liquor stores. She's had, for the past 5 years, she's been a clerk working 40 plus hours at a liquor store in Peabody called 17 Central Street Liquors. And Mr. Ketan Patel, he has also worked at both the stores in Worcester and in Pepperell, so he too has had experience. And Ricky, I'm not sure if Ricky's had experience in the beer and wine, but he's been helping to run this store here in Wakefield, and I've been told by the health department that he's been doing a really good job. All in all, between these four parties here, we believe that Route 28 Lucky Mart is a good hands and would be a good candidate to have the transfer of beer and wine take place. The health department has provided us with a letter of recommendation. I'd just like to pass this around in a number of copies. They are very supportive of the proposition and wanted to express that in letter form. And at this time, I would be happy to answer any questions you may have.
Mr. Chairman, just have a quick question.
Mr. Yu.
Yeah. Would you please go over the breakdown of these sales?
Sure.
Again, please.
These are not exact, but they're approximate what they are to date. Approximately 33% is lottery. And when I say lottery, it's not the gross sales, because it's just out of whack. It's the lottery commissions. So in order to make it apples to apples, we broke it down with lottery commission sales, because that is more representative of what those sales comprise of the total sales.
Gotcha.
Approximately 43% are tobacco products. That includes cigarettes and the cigars, which are in the humidor. And approximately 24% are the remaining items, including snacks, candy, drinks, pharmacy items, pet foods, household goods, etc. When they did their projections as to what the beer and wine would bring to the store, they anticipated, especially based upon Mr. Pendleton's own information and input, that approximately 20 to 25% would comprise their sales of beer and wine if a beer and wine component was added.
That would really be an add-on, not a...
Yes.
So that would change the numbers.
It would change, yes, it would change the numbers.
No, that's fine, but yeah, it
would
be an add-on.
It would change, of course it would change the numbers.
And it would be an add-on,
I mean, yes.
Because it's a whole new product. And,
right.
Okay, thank you.
Now, how long have they been in operation? I kind of lost track.
October 1st.
Since October, okay.
And I believe Mr. Pendleton will corroborate the fact that they've been a very good tenant. I mean, I've seen the store now maybe 3 or 4 times. It's a well-run store. I know these guys. These guys run, if you've seen their other stores, they run a tip-top ship. And this is just another example of their running a tip-top ship.
So when this came before us, and it wasn't this group, right?
Correct.
We turned it down primarily because of the restrictions on the lease, which prevented what we felt at the time, a business that didn't make a lot of sense. Meaning they were limited to what they could sell.
Well, they weren't in conformity to the, right? to the lease.
Well, I wasn't here for that vote.
Okay.
I was absent then.
Okay.
But my understanding is...
Let me finish.
Go ahead.
Okay.
Yep.
So I'm just trying to... Is that your understanding, Michael? Was that we were concerned associated with the fact that the lease restricted
right, they
what they could sell in
they
the store.
In conformity to the
right.
lease.
Now, they've come before us here tonight, and they've at least they've made a little more sense out of a business, right? Because what was presented to us before didn't have all the detail of what they're doing. They're selling cigarettes, cigars, and they're selling stuff in there that I thought was restricted, but maybe I'm not sure.
You know, I read line for line the restrictive deed. I have a copy of it.
Yeah, no, I'm just, you know, what I imagined back then
yeah.
and what they said they were going
to
do.
I think Mike wants to sit yes. and I can follow up too.
No, if it's okay with you, Mr. Chairman,
yes.
I would like to hold off on my comment until after the public hearing is closed.
Okay, sure.
And I'll have my discussion right. during the board's discussion. But to answer your question, we had this is our third, maybe no, our fourth. Our fourth go around? At least our third. And
these aren't the same.
Doesn't matter. It's the same topic.
Yes.
Same license. It's a third go around. So it isn't, has nothing to do. Is this, if the reason why it didn't go through the last time was, again, associated with the fact related to the CIT. You heard our youth services director in here today. You just heard from this lawyer. Over almost 80% of the sales are related to lottery and tobacco. And the issue why that went down last time was about need. We have a lot. We have a liquor store across the street at one stop. We have one two blocks down at Eastgate.
Yeah.
The need is satisfied. Our job and responsibility is about need. Excuse me, sir. So if you want to promote tobacco and gambling and then add lottery onto it, that's one of the reasons why I failed the second or the third time that we did this. The first time was the lease was, they weren't following the lease.
All right.
If I may, with all due respect, I mean, this statute is pretty clear as to what this board should be considering tonight. This is Chapter 138, Section 15, Transfer of License. Not a new application, it's not a new location. I concur with you as to if this was a new location, which I informed was the last hearing that you had, those are all legitimate concerns, legitimate issues to bring before the board. But the only issue that's before the board, per the statute, is whether or not they meet the requirements of the ABCC. Age requirements, citizenship requirements, residency requirements, and CORI requirements, no felony convictions. Whether or not the proposed transferee is of good character. The issues as to location, need, public need, and all those things do not apply in this setting.
Any other questions from the board members? Anyone sitting in the audience questions? Public hearing.
Good evening. Thanks again for your patience for hearing similar type application. My name is Ken Doherty. I represent Captain Pizza and Mr. Papadopoulos, the owner of the site. I believe the last time this was before you, it was for a different location. And I do believe that the first time it was before you, that applicant had suggested that he was going to run a convenience store, which was clearly in contradiction to what the lease and the deed
was. That was the first time.
Right? That's the first time. Right? And the last time, excuse me, the last time was a different location.
Right.
And having come to these hearings, it seems to me that there's been, and rightly so, a concern and a consideration both for the business owners in this community and for the need or the wants and desires of the people of this community. And I think the proof is in the pudding as far as the wants and desires of the people, because this license has been at this location for some 40-something years, and people have been frequenting that. Mr. Pennington is here. He used to run the Tedeschi Food Store, convenience store, that was there prior to the deed restriction. And I believe if questioned, he would tell you that the community routinely purchased the tobacco products and the lottery products and the beer and wine products. And though he carried those convenience store items as pursuant to his contract with Tedeschi's, every week, 10 days or whatever it was, he was getting rid of the bread products that never sold. So the community, the people that lived here, they went to that place. This is what they bought. This is what they wanted. And it's a complementary business to my client's business. Right next door, he sells pizza and sandwiches. He still gets comments today, he tells me. People say, it's too bad I can't get a beer next door. You know, it was always so convenient. He doesn't know. He can't come before you now and say he's actually lost business. But he speculates that he probably has, because he's still getting such comments. And again, so you get the business. You have Mr. Pendleton, who's been a business man in this community, trying to get a dollar back on his investment. You have people that are applying today. They've been running a business here since October. They have a history in the business. And of course, you have the business owner that bought the property, thinking that he was going and put together the people with Mr. Pendleton to get this license transfer. So between the business concerns that I think the board should be aware of, and in the community, the proof is in the pudding. This is where they would go. Mr. Pendleton, when he ran that store, he sold a lot of beer and wine there. And so I hope that you, it's third time before. I think it's a little bit different than the first two times, and we ask that you approve it.
Any other comments from the parties requesting the license? Yes, ma'am.
Good evening, gentlemen and madame. I am completely unofficial, but just ask you to, I'm Christiana Papadopoulou, registered nurse and wife of Stelios, owner of Captain Pizza for 30 years. I can vouch, as I've said in previous meetings, that folks have asked us all of the time, and those folks, several hundred of them, signed the petition when this first came to our attention, to bring it to your attention, that they're asking you to keep the liquor license at the premises because it is convenient. It is not an issue of gambling and, you know, loose alcohol consumption. It is a place where they can pick up their food for their family and their six-pack of beer. It has been that way for 40 years, and we're asking it to continue. I'm very happy that I got to hear the new HR director. He said that, you know, you provide a great service. What we brought forth to you in that petition from the residents of North Reading is them asking you to be of service for those little conveniences. I understand that there is a facility that sells beer very close to us, but when you have your kids in the car and you want to just, you're coming home from work and you're buying a pizza and you want a six pack of beer or a lottery ticket, that's what they're asking you for. That's what they asked you, and I let you know at that time that we were willing to offer more. People still ask us, do you need us to sign the petition? What's going on? So the residents of North Reading fully support this. It's what they know. It's what they've voiced to us. If these meetings didn't go on at almost 10 p.m., there would be many that would come and speak for you with you. So we just ask for what was there to remain there. Stelios has been a taxpayer, a businessman, small business operator for 30 years plus there, and we were community members. We're community members, and we ask that you just consider that, in, as Mr. Doherty said, in And the other attorney said, in the transfer, this is not a new application. This is, you know, this is where it's been, this is where we ask you to consider it to continue. Thank you.
Thank you. Any other comments from the audience?
Evening, Chris Pendleton, Tewksbury, Mass. Just want to speak in support of Lucky Mart. I know I've been in there a couple times, and they've done more improvements in the building to the business in 6 months than Tedeschi's did in 15 years when they owned it. I had very restrictive whether I could do anything to it. They've painted, cleaned it up, and it looks really nice in there. I've also been in their Wakefield location, which is another former Tedeschi's, and they do run a really good shop. And I also have a lot of empathy for their applicant. When I first took over the store, I was there 6 months without a license as well during the transfer. So I know how much of an impact it'll have on their overall business. And I just hope that you approve the transfer.
Thank you. Name and address, sir, when you get up there.
Ed Pronovost, I've been a resident in town for almost 50 years. And I've been frequently at that store ever since it's opened in the 70s. I've known every owner there, and I can concur with what Chris says. That's the best I've ever seen that store it's ever been. And my concern is the people from Andover, when they come down this way and stuff like that, you say there's other stores further down the road. Well, do we want all that traffic all the time going that way and crossing 28, things like that, to try to get Rear Windsor's convenience store here and they can just turn around and go back, you know? Things of that nature. It's just, it's always been a convenience there. And it's always been a composite store to its location. So it's, you know, I don't have anything other than to say that it is a real convenience to be there. So.
Thank you. Anyone else before I close the public hearing? All right, public hearing is closed. Board members?
Yeah. I believe, and I'm almost certain of this, it's not an entitlement to grant this license or to grant this transfer. It's not, we're not required to do it. And it's based on need. I understand what your sales pitch is on this, but I don't believe it's true. And I think we have to, as the board, have to look at what is the need for the town. And when we have issues in town, and when you have a new business that's focused on smokes and snacks, and we really want to increase that by throwing alcohol on top of it, I'm not going to vote for it. You all know I wasn't going to vote for it anyway. I don't know how the board's going to vote. You only have 3 voters tonight, so your advantage is good. But think about the future, and we have a new property that we're out trying to market right down the road that may need a liquor license. We don't have money left, if we even have any left. I'm not even sure. So you make your decision any way you want, but what you're promoting here is cigarettes and lottery with alcohol.
Mr. Yule.
All businessmen know that need is defined by supply and demand. If no one's going to buy it, there's no need. If people go out buy it, there must be a need. Whether it's a need that I would prefer is unimportant. We have an opportunity here for growth. Business is going to grow because they're going to add a product to their establishment. They're also showing that they are neat, they are clean. I've never seen a public health director of any town put something like this together, a letter which to me is a recommendation. Competition is very important. Just because we have stores established in town
doesn't mean another store won't benefit the town through competition. So I look at it strictly as small business, and I support small business, but opportunities to grow their business and to satisfy what townspeople wish to buy. All right. I personally stay away from the lottery. I'm not a great drinker, by any sense, and I haven't smoked in years. So you're not getting much out of me. But who am I to say what other people should do? So I don't subscribe to that approach. I think competition is important, and I don't think government, small, medium, large, should be imposing a lot of its overregulation on businesses. I don't think we should be discriminatory on the businesses. Again, the public buys or they don't buy. And you're either going to survive with this or you're not going to survive. As our town grows, that means your business will grow, as will other businesses will grow. It might be, the town might grow so much that you will have to move because your business is getting bigger. And that would be good for the town. Okay? Again, I'm not a fan of the products you sell, but, you know, I don't begrudge anybody doing what they want to do. So I would be voting in support of this because I think it's good for business, it's good for small business, and it's good for the town.
Mr. O'Leary.
I don't see this as promoting or expanding anything different that hasn't been there for over 40 years. And I've been going in and out of that strip mall and Captain's and Tedeschi's and Little Peach before that, and I think there was something in between before it. I was in there at 6:20 this evening, and Steve, generally, I like the bottles rather than the cans. So that's why, you know, I go buy my sandwich there and go next door and get a bottle. And again, you know, to me, as a matter of convenience and what people have come to expect and people have been doing in the way of, whether it be habitual, frequenting of this particular establishment, the expectation is that beer and wine license was there, has been there, and should continue to be there, at least from the some of the input that I've had over the last several months and when we first turned it down. Now, as far as the first applicant that came in here, to me, struck me as a bit disingenuous and not being very forthright in relation to exactly what he was going to be doing and what he could actually was allowed to do in terms of conditional lease. And I think when we continued the hearing last July, when they came in, we said, you just tell us what you're going to be doing. If you're going to have a craft beer and wine or do something different than what's there, let us know. It just left us with a bad taste in our mouth. We continued the hearing, and unfortunately I was on vacation and I wasn't here to vote on. The second applicant for a transfer of license, this one here, was at a totally different location where we had previously determined that there wasn't a substantive need, and there was some opposition in the neighborhood for its location. Never have I heard of any complaints in relation to the location of a beer and wine license at this particular establishment. And in addition to that, there's no doubt that the convenience of it in relation to Captain's Pizza, if people go in there, buy their sandwiches and their pizza, and go next door to buy a six-pack of beer or a bottle of wine to bring home with them, is an augmentation where one establishment, you know, supplements the other. And I think that's a good thing to promote. You know, as far as the differences in products that are being offered in this particular establishment, it's pretty much just the dairy products that aren't being offered here and some of the canned goods. The current owners have done a fantastic job of cleaning the establishment up, and it's very clean, and it's a good-looking store. It's a beautiful-looking store. You've done a fine job. I want to compliment you on that. So I have no problem with the license remaining at this particular location, and I will be voting in favor and support of it. I think it's a good idea.
Thank you, Steve. I've listened to this several times. I guess at this point, I can support this store because, one, they've showed that they could make a business out of something we didn't believe, based on what we heard before, from not from you, but from somebody else. So rather than spend a lot more time on this, I will entertain a motion, Mr. Yule. Unless other board members have additional comments. Hearing none, Mr. Yule.
Yes, Mr. Chairman, I move to transfer the package store wine and malt beverage license held by Pendleton Ventures, Inc. to Smokes and Snacks, Inc., DBA Lucky Mart, 202 North Street, subject to all regulatory department requirements.
Do I hear a second?
Second.
Second, Mr. O'Leary.
Just one of the comments, Mr. Chairman.
Mr. O'Leary.
I also want to thank the owners for their consideration in name change in order to accommodate what some people found offensive in relation to what you're originally proposing. And I think that goes a long way, too, as far as indicating that you're looking to work with us here in the community. And you know, thank you very much for changing it to Lucky Mart.
Just a clarification relative to comments made concerning the memorandum from the Board of Health. While I do believe that the memorandum from the Board of Health is identifying some occurrences that have taken place involving this particular establishment, I did not see anywhere in there that there was a recommendation from the Board of Health. So I want to make sure that that's clear to folks.
Yes.
Thank you.
Before we vote, don't let me down. Good luck with the business.
Thank you.
On the motion, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed?
No.
The motion carries 3-1 with one member of the board absent. Thank you.
Thank you.
Good luck.
Thank you. Okay, next item on our agenda is amend the Subway Common Victual License for Lower Road, new owner.
Good luck.
Mr. Gilberto?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Do you have a comment on this? Or?
No comment other than there is a new owner for this particular location, and they've requested that our records be modified accordingly. There is no alcoholic beverage license at this establishment. It is purely a common victualer license that the board's being asked to amend.
Jeff, you have a motion on Subway?
Were those the motions that were not in the packet?
I have it.
You got them?
Yep,
okay.
I do. Mr. Chairman, I move to amend the Subway Common Vittler's license located at 4 Lowell Road to reflect J. Mack, Inc. as the new owner.
Do I hear a second?
Second.
Second by Mr. O'Leary. Further discussion? Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? It's unanimous. 4-1 member absent. Next item on our agenda is seasonal license renewals for Robert Connors, transient vendor. He's the flower guy.
Yep. Oh, sure.
Mr. Yule, when you're ready.
As long as it's when I'm ready. Okay. Mr. Chairman, I move to renew the transient vendor license for the sale of flowers, Christmas trees, etc., at 226 Main Street for Robert Connors, 58 Wyman Street, Woburn, Massachusetts, to expire December 31st, 2017, subject to all regulatory department requirements.
Second.
Second by Mr. O'Leary. Any discussion? Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Unanimous. We also have Golf Facilities Management, Inc., Common Victula, and that's what the Hillview down below.
That's correct, yes.
Yes.
Mr. Yule, do we have a motion?
We do, as a matter of fact. Mr. Chairman, I move to renew the Common Victula's license for Golf Facilities Management, Inc., DBA, Hillview Snack Bar, to expire December 31, 2017, subject to all regulatory department requirements.
Do I hear a second?
Second.
Second by Mr. O'Leary. Further discussion? Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Unanimous. Next item is to review and approve the recreational marijuana prohibition ballot question. Mr. Gilberto.
What happened to Thompson? There was separate articles for
separate
motions for Thompson Club.
Yeah.
Tonight's packet.
We have.
Oh, there's another one that's not on our agenda?
There's two more.
Yep.
I saw the motions, you're right. Do you have them?
I do. There you go. Mr. Chairman, I move to renew the seasonal club wine and malt beverages license for Thompson Club Inc. DBA Pro Shop 2A Mid Iron Drive to expire October 31, 2017, subject to all regulatory department requirements.
Do I hear a second?
Second.
Second by Mr. O'Leary. Any discussion?
Yeah, I do
Michael.
Have a question.
Okay. Is this the same manager as last year, or they changed the manager again?
No. Well, this is the one. This is the pro shop. This is different than the new facility that they built. And I have a question on the new facility I built because I understand that the manager of record is no longer there.
Right. That's why I'm asking, too. I'm a little confused on what you're
saying. So, no, this one here is the pro shop. Where
just
they
the
just
pro
sell,
shop.
Yeah, this is a pro shop.
So it's not associated with the upstairs.
It's the other one. This is the TCC Grill. This is the one that one there I would suggest holding off on to find out if it's a manager.
Well, we're not onto that yet.
I know, yeah.
My Mr. Chairman?
Yes.
My question is, why are we doing this now? I mean, shouldn't this been done?
No.
It's seasonal.
It's seasonal.
It's not an annual. It's not
seasonal.
A year-end necessary. Mr. Gilberto has an answer.
Yes.
And Mr. Chairman, as Ms. Brooks indicated, these license renewals came in late. They are seasonal licenses. We're trying to accommodate to the extent that we can the businesses here in town, which are seasonal in nature. And knowing that there's a couple of weeks between now and the next board meeting, there was a change in the manager of record. Once the licensed operator of the restaurant at Thompson, once it was determined that they would no longer be holding the license, and the board approved the change, I think in January, Jane, is that right?
That's the next license.
That's the next
TCC,
one.
But I understand is no longer there.
Right.
But the individual that I believe is the manager of record for both licenses, that individual.
That's why I asked the question. I think it's supposed to be the manager. Well, it was the manager of both licenses, but I don't know. I'm confused.
Mr. Steele.
No. I'm just, I think Steve had a question.
So the issue is with the next motion, not the...
Yeah.
This one, right?
At the end of the season last year, changed again. And then they came in, they had the same manager for both the pro shop and upstairs. And I believe it was a gentleman.
Joe McCarthy.
Yes.
Joe McCarthy.
So now I'm not clear on what they're doing.
Motion. Was their application different than them?
No, the application lists Joe McCarthy as the manager of both. Just like Anna Pepe was the manager of both.
Okay.
Maybe I don't recall voting on that.
Yeah.
Change your manager to Mr. McCarthy from Anna Pepe.
Yeah, no, that did happen.
No, I believe that did happen.
I misread it then. I thought he was only on. I had my iPad died, so I apologize. I thought he was just going to be the upstairs, and there was a different name in the downstairs.
Okay. The application had him for both.
Yes.
So their applications submitted were for both. If there is an issue in terms of an inconsistency with the transfer that was approved, it'll certainly be caught through the ABCC process, if in fact that is the case. But I know, I don't believe it was Joe that was here. It was
Tim Hooten
who was here on behalf that evening.
But, Mr. Chair, I think from what Mr. Pisco was saying, when Pepe, is that the woman's name?
Yeah,
okay. No. Did she had one and he had the other?
Correct.
At one time?
Yeah,
and
one
then
time.
They got, and then he took over both, or whoever the guy is took over both?
So through you, Mr. Chairman, there was only one license at one point.
That's right, they split.
And then they added a second license. Right. And we adjusted the paperwork, and that second license was to be in Ms. Pepe's name, and it was in Ms. Pepe's name. And then the Thompson Club came back and indicated that the licensee would no longer be holding the license, and the board was asked to approve that change of the manager of record back to the individual who was the, or to the individual who had was the manager of record for the first license.
Okay. So we're in good order then.
So are we okay with proceeding with the motions?
The motion, I just need to vote now.
One of them.
On this one.
You seconded it?
Right, you did, yes.
On the motion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Unanimous? We have the second motion, which is for the restaurant, right?
Mr. Chairman, I move to renew the seasonal club all alcohol. Sorry about that. All alcohol. License. All alcohol license for the Thompson Club, Inc., DBA, TCC Grill, 2 Mid-Iron Drive, to expire October 31, 2017, subject to all regulatory department requirements.
Do I hear a second?
I'll second.
Second by Mr. Prisco. Discussion.
Again, I just don't recall it again. Maybe I wasn't at the meeting. I don't recall as far as the transfer from Ms. Pepe into Mr. McCarthy's name.
But they've verified it.
No. I know that. But I just I don't know what role Mr. McCarthy is now playing in relation to the operations of that facility. Is he there on a daily basis? Is he in charge of the catering or whatever? What was operating the kitchen there? I mean, Ms. Pepe was a hands-on operator, going to be there, you know, during the course of all the functions that were going to take place. I don't, and again, I apologize for not recalling if I was there, but my guess is I would have asked some of the similar questions, but maybe I'm losing it. But again, it may have been a meeting that I wasn't at. I don't know whether Mr. McCarthy is involved in the day-to-day operations of the function hall portion of that facility. So,
Mr. Chair?
We have a motion on the floor. Mr. Prisco seconded it.
Right.
Mr. Ewing.
Yeah. So in thinking this thing out, because we do want to get it right, obviously, but in thinking this thing out, we would have known then the role that, who's the gentleman again? McCarthy?
McCarthy, I guess.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. We would have known then the role that he was playing.
The questions we need answers to? Mr. O'Leary, you have a question as to whether or not he's there full time.
Whether he's actually operating the license.
I don't believe he's there on the premises.
So maybe we should hold off on this. I guess that's what I'm trying to get to.
All right, so Mr. Prisco, if you would draw your second.
I'll withdraw my motion.
Continue.
No, continue
until our next meeting and get some answers.
Well, that's why I was going to say just withdraw it, and we'll put it on the agenda for our next meeting. And what I was asking, what are the questions that we need answers to so that we can take action on it? I guess there's one, right?
Yeah, my concern is that the person who holds the license, generally we've been asking that they be present in operating the facilities, and because they're the ones who are ultimately responsible for the activities that take place there. to me, just based upon the initial application for this whole thing, which I oppose, by the way, this just appears to be, and I could be wrong, and, just a way in which the Thompson Club organization can avoid coming before the board with the daily operations manager, the person who's ultimately going to be responsible for serving of alcohol on a regular basis, coming before us. They're just putting an individual's name on the license who may not have anything to do with the function hall facility. Michael has a comment or question.
It was presented to us that way, that he was going to be present, but my, from what I've been hearing, is that is not present, that it's not being executed the way it was presented to us. But I'd like to get verification. I hope I'm wrong on that case, but I believe if what I'm hearing is true, then I think we have an issue, and I think it's got to be addressed.
Well, we have a choice. We have a motion on the table. We could vote it down, or we can just withdraw the motions and put it on the agenda for our next meeting and ask the town administrator to invite the individual who's requesting the license or whose name is on the license to attend our meeting. Therefore, he would be available to answer the questions that board members might have.
All right. If that's what you'd like to do, Mr. Chairman, I will withdraw my second.
Okay. And Mr. Yule will withdraw his motion, and we'll put that item on the agenda for our next meeting.
April 3rd.
Invite someone to come and explain who's doing what.
So just so that we're all clear, we've approved the pro shop license, but not the grill license.
Right.
And we're going to invite the manager of record and or leadership from the Thompson Club to the April 3rd meeting to discuss the restaurant license.
Right. Okay, town review June town meeting articles. I take it there's a list. Right?
There is a list, yes.
Already?
And yes.
Just set through a town
finish
meeting.
One town meeting and on to the next.
Yeah, well, this is why we're having so many meetings.
Mr. Chairman, through you, if the board members do have their electronic devices, they can find the listing in the meeting packet for tonight, March 20th, 2017.
Yeah, it's a separate document, though.
That's
right?
Correct. It says 2017 ATM list. Mr. Prisco, I have a paper copy if you'd like it.
I can't back up.
I have it.
He's going to give you a hard copy.
Bring it up.
It came back up. Good. Thank you.
Anyone else would like a paper copy?
Yeah, I've got it.
Oh, yeah. We have to talk about the recreational marijuana one first, Bob.
Yeah. Beginning recreational marijuana.
Before you get to the town meeting.
Yes. Sorry.
The ballot question.
So what is it that we need to talk about?
You would approve the recreational marijuana ballot question.
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay. I don't know. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Did they get added to Dropbox late?
It's in the main packet. It's just a motion, Mr. Chairman.
Oh, no, I'm not talking about that.
While you look for it, I have to excuse myself.
Thought I copied them all. Oh, yeah. I missed that. Annual town meeting list. So we've got a motion?
Yeah, Mike just stepped out.
Mike just stepped out.
And I'm looking for the motion. I got it lost in here somewhere.
Yeah, we have a spare copy if you'd like.
Okay. Give me the spare copy. God damn it.
There you go. Come on.
Oh, well.
I sworn I copied that. Maybe I didn't.
Maybe I can read the motion, or should I wait for Mike?
Let me see it coming down the hall.
You have to put the speakers in the bathroom now.
Stop out of the Capitol. Go for it.
Didn't copy.
I found it. Mr. Chairman, I move to place the following question on the ballot for the annual town election to be held May 2, 2017. Shall the town prohibit the operation of all types of marijuana establishments as defined in GLC 94G Section 1, including marijuana cultivators, marijuana testing facilities, marijuana product manufacturers, marijuana retailers, or any other type of licensed marijuana-related business with the town of North Reading?
Second.
Second by Mr. O'Leary. Discussion.
In reading it, and I know the difference, but in reading it, I'm not seeing it. Medical marijuana is not part of this. Okay, we know that.
That's a different general law.
It's the, okay, so the law is
the general law.
Okay, thank you. That answers the question. You know, I'd like to add, if you don't mind, Mr. Chairman, just for general public, I think at least one of the reasons is that the town, the residents of North Reading voted at 54% to not have recreational marijuana sold in the town.
State.
What?
It's on the state.
The state voted for it, but the town of North Reading did not at 54%. So we did not support it, and that's why we're able to take this step to ensure that hopefully, depending on what's going on at the state level and at the federal level, to prevent this, the brick and mortar, so to speak, sale of marijuana.
All right, on the motion to put this on the ballot question in May, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Unanimous. Next item on our agenda is to review the annual town meeting warrant items, of which right now there's 39 and counting. Michael, you want to quickly go through these, or
sure.
Do you want me to?
No, I'm happy to go through them, Mr. Chairman. Going from the top, we have the first six items which relate to this current fiscal year's budget.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Including addressing the budget, snow and ice deficit, funding for deposit into or transfer into the capital improvement to stabilization fund, as well as the water stabilization and the general stabilization fund. And there'll be additional detail as we get closer to town meeting after the result of the work of the financial planning team is complete. We also have the transfer into the other post-employment benefits trust fund, if any. And then transferring funds to the solid waste stabilization fund, depending upon the performance of that program. The next six or so are routine items, going through number 13, which is prior year bills. 14, 15, and 16 are three warrant articles relative to construction for the MWRA project. They are the construction of the pump station itself, construction of the water system improvements in North Reading, and the construction of the water system improvements in the town of Reading. These three articles have also separately been submitted. These three projects have separately been submitted to the Capital Improvement Planning Committee for review as well. But much in the way we handled the design and the admittance to the MWRA last June, there, as currently listed here, they would be separate warrant articles for discussion. They would then be followed
have
by...
Have they been discussed yet?
With the capital?
Yeah.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Any issues, Steve and Jeff?
No.
No.
17 and 18 are the operating and capital expenditures budgets. 19... appropriate funds for the construction of the facilities at Arthur J. Kenny Field. 20, rescinds an authorization to borrow, if any. 21, appropriation of band premiums to reduce middle and high school project borrowing costs. These are the proceeds from short-term borrowing that we have that need to be utilized towards the middle school project in order to comply with the appropriate law. 22 is our funding for any retirement obligations that are projected to occur in fiscal year 2018. 23 and 24 are transfers into the solid waste and other post-employment benefit liability trust funds. 25, appropriation of funding for special counsel legal expenses associated with the secondary school building project. 26, funding town hall slash fire feasibility study. This is an item that had some very cursory discussion that took place at the February budget hearing. And it's an article that is a follow-up to the work that to the needs we are aware are in place down at the fire station, as well as the board strategic planning discussion relative to the town hall. Again, this is obviously the first time the board will be having a full discussion relative to this matter, and I'm sure there'll be much more discussion moving down the road. But that's what that article would address. 27, submitted by the Planning Commission, would be an update to the master plan. 28 through 32 are revolving funds to be reauthorized. 36 are all reauthorization of revolving funds. 37, something that we've had some discussion with the police department would be for the regulation of drones. And just to give a quick summary as to the reason there, something that was identified by the police department when they were shooting the movie production here in town 2 years ago. And fortunately, there was some voluntary compliance. The issue was resolved fairly easily. But it identified a concern in that there's some pretty open law with regard to the use of drones, and the requirement really is to be within a certain number of feet of those drones. The police department's concern is the potential for invasion of privacy and what they would be able to do, if anything, if called by a neighbor, for example, or another property owner. Their enforcement may be very limited. So it's something that we've had an initial conversation with town council on, but would continue working on through this process.
Mr. Chairman? Yes. I, too, had a conversation with the chief on it, and I think I mentioned it briefly to the TA. There's a bigger issue here with drones that we probably need to start delving into what protections we can take on behalf of our residents. And I'm not going to pretend to have any idea how to do this or anything like that. We may have to talk to our representatives because I think the vision that I see is that you're going to have drones running all over the place, and they're going to be running close to people's property as far as height is concerned. All right, and as you say, the invasion of privacy. So I think it's something that we need to start the groundwork on, trying to find out what's going on, what's being done by the state, by the federal government. And start working towards that. So it's a huge concern, I think. The CPC, some years ago, addressed the issue of wind turbines before there were any wind turbines in town. And so they addressed it. And hopefully the solutions they came up with, the work that they came up on it worked, but they did address it. So I think we need to start watching out for the welfare of our constituents.
Well, I suspect that's why there's an article in here, and who's going to be putting that together?
It'd be myself and the police chief working with town council. This would be a general bylaw, not a zoning bylaw.
And then I'm thinking, I'm more worried about Amazon, and I'm worried about FedEx and all that, and having the...
You're not worried about me flying my zone?
No.
Just Al.
But I think it's something that maybe we need to be watching out, being very sensitive to. And this is a good starting point. this will help us out. But that's basically talking about an individual doing a drone. Am I right? Is that my...
That's the concern that's been relayed to me by the police chief.
Right, that's very limited. That's very, I'm thinking much bigger than that, so.
Okay. Snow removal, streets and sidewalks. This is a general bylaw. What, this is an amendment to something we have already?
It's further modification of the existing sidewalk snow removal bylaw, which was modified approximately a year ago, maybe a year and a half ago. I've had some conversation with the police chief, and you know, fortunately, with this particular winter, their recurrence has been not been as significant as it was, say, two winters ago. But there are still concerns, and I think chief among them is that despite the best efforts that we've put out there with regard to educating businesses, compliance is spotty at best with regard to this. And having some conversation with the police chief, I think he and I are on the same page that we need to tighten the language up and have it such so that we don't need to go through the rigors of the verbal and then written warning before actually getting to a period in time where we can get the snow physically removed because of the safety concern of the snow being on a sidewalk. So the intention here, and again, it'll be formulated further between now and the next review of the articles, but the intention here would effectively be to move away from the scenario of having to have the warning, either the verbal or written warning, because of the manpower required to do so. Basically, police officers out, either in vehicle or on foot, depending upon the area, trying to contact the responsible person, which can be a challenge. And where we see it coming is rather there would be a combination of a fine in the appropriate amount and the town assessing the cost of removing the snow using its resources, whether public works personnel or contractor. You may recall from the discussion that we had previously, we were kind of caught in the situation where we were concerned that just billing the cost back might not be enough of an incentive. So the direction we see it being would be both the fine, a significant fine, and assessing the costs from the Public Works Department. That would be effectively the first step in the enforcement. Of course, after a seasonal notification is sent out.
I think whatever the proposal is going to be, or even conceptually what the proposal is going to be, I think should be run by, you know, the organization that we could disseminate the information through most quickly would be the Chamber of Commerce. I think it would be important to present that to them, at least conceptually what we're looking to do, as early as possible, so we get some feedback. And again, the problem, of course, is you're going to assess the property owner, you're going to assess the business, which is a lot of the problem here, because a lot of the leases are triple net anyway. So I think we need to just communicate with the business community as soon as possible, that that's what is on the docket here.
Chairman?
I think that's a good idea.
Just Chairman. Question.
Yes.
Yes. Say something. Can I say something?
Yes.
Oh, okay.
Sorry.
Okay. Regarding the Chamber of Commerce, you know, we went through this a bunch of times, and they made us a promise a couple of years ago. They needed 1 year to pull this together, and they'll have everybody in compliance. And now we're here we are 3, maybe 4 years later, and we still have the problem. I was extremely upset yesterday and today, all right? I haven't been out on the road doing my running or anything like that. One primary reason I can't run anymore, so now I'm walking, okay? So I've got a 5-mile walk, and I wound up in a very precarious situation. I'm coming up Main Street. I can't get to Walmart from Park Street. You can't get there because you get so far and then it's all snow, all right, including Walmart. So I go across the street because I see that it seems to be have been cleared. I go up to, yesterday it was before, before Stop and Shop, okay? Okay, and there was no place for me to go. All right, so I had to go out in the street and had my back to traffic. That's a very frightening experience, okay? I dealt with it. Same thing happened on Winter Street. today I go out, and it looks like somebody did some snow removal, because I was able to go past up to the, those apartments, the trailer houses. So I was able to get that far. Then I crossed the street and I faced the traffic, and I just did the best that I could. Then I went back, so I have to, you know, keep going back, traversing the road. Okay, I'm doing it, I'm a selectman, you know, and I'm sharing this with you. But there are people that actually try to walk to Walmart. And I don't know if it's five people or whether it's 20 people or three people. I don't know. But when you talk about the value of a life and putting them at risk, that concerns me. And we've gone through this for so long. And it's come to the point where it's, you know, just move the gosh darn snow. You know, and how we do it at some point, it doesn't matter. We have a bylaw, and I agree, it's a lousy bylaw. I concur with that. All right, and tightening it up would be great. But I think we need to tighten it up now and not go into any deliberation, so that when next winter comes, we're set and ready to remove the snow. And for those who do not conform to the bylaw, get on the hook.
What am I reading here? It's right in
I understand.
Town meeting.
I understand. I just don't want, Steve made a suggestion that we talk to the Chamber of Commerce.
I think you should.
Okay, and we did, and we're still here. So I'm just reminding you that we, you know, this has only been talked a lot because we talk a lot. All right, it's time to get it done, and hopefully this will do it. That's my point, okay? But it's still been dangerous for people walking up Main Street and walking along.
Which is why we have the current bylaw. It just doesn't seem to be functioning, working well for the administration, so they're proposing a change. And all I suggested was let them know what the proposed change is.
Yeah. All right, the last article is Main Street mixed-use overlay. I take it that's CPC article?
It is, and I believe it was a carryover from the discussions relative to the Berry property.
Yeah, right.
So it's not unanticipated.
Okay. We got work to do. Clearly. Back to our agenda.
Minutes.
Okay, let's go to the regular session minutes.
Yeah, the minutes of March 6, 2017, regular session.
Okay, Mr. Chairman, I move to approve the March 6th, 2017 regular session minutes as written.
Do I hear a second?
Second.
Second by Mr. O'Leary. Any discussion? Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Unanimous. We also have an executive session of March 6th, 2017, and that may be one that you excuse yourself from, if I recall. So, can I entertain a motion? You can read the motion.
Mr. Chairman, I move to approve the March 6th, 2017 executive session minutes. Should I say as written? I guess I have to say.
Do we hear a second?
Second.
Second by Mr. O'Leary.
Okay, Mr. Chairman?
Yes.
Yeah. Just want to let you know that I recused myself at this meeting, and I did not take part in the discussions concerning the health insurance, where it says paragraph 1, 2, 3, 4, the chairman Mosseri, Mr. Prisco, Mrs. Manipelli, and Mr. Yule are in favor of IPG's proposal.
Okay, on the motion.
So it should be amended.
Well, that needs to be amended? What? You say it needs to be amended?
Well, it needs to be amended because I wasn't participating.
Okay.
Yeah. That's all.
So that would be as amended.
As amended. On the motion, all in favor?
Aye.
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 Michael?
I said aye.
Unanimous. Town Administrator's report.
Mr. Chairman, I'll just offer an update relative to a couple of things, financial in nature. The first is relative to snow and ice expenses for this season. We're up to 31 events this season to either treat roads, or plow, or both. Five of the events warranted calling in contractors to plow, and this was as of March 16th, by the way. Approximately 57.75 inches of measurable snow has fallen.
the March 14th storm being 11 inches of that. 1,895 tons of salt, a total cost of $113,513. Approximately 11,550 gallons of calcium chloride for a total cost of $12,012. Total cost incurred to date, as of March 15th, $424,495. And just for the record, again, we have an operating budget of $175,000, and then we carry an additional $250,000 allowance, which would put us basically right there in terms of both of those numbers. And then for our financial planning purposes going into FY18, we are carrying $500,000 allowance in free cash for budgetary purposes. And the second thing that I'll just note is that the work relative to the financial planning team and the overall FY18 budget process continues. I believe that there is a more recently updated spreadsheet from the last financial planning team meeting that should be in the FY2018 folder, so I would encourage folks to take a look at it in there if you have not already.
Old and new business, Mr. O'Leary.
I just want to comment on the attendance of the special town meeting and again note our appreciation for those that did show up. I mean, we had some pretty important matters to discuss, not the least of which was the rezoning of the Berry property, bring about the necessary changes in order to effectuate the sale of the property and the development. And again, appreciate behalf of the Athletic Facility Subcommittee, town meeting's patience with us in trying to come forth with the most expeditious, cost-effective way of addressing the needs for the Arthur Kenny Field bathroom facilities. And again, in relation to the marijuana question, I think they spoke pretty loud and clear, and now the people at the ballot will have a final say. So on that, I just want to thank everybody for coming out, taking the time to participate with us and support our efforts to move things forward. So, Mr. Chairman, thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Ewing?
Yes, I concur. We had a good turnout at the town meeting. I think it's very important, regardless of the results. Anytime that the community gets together and decides to make a decision, that's good. I always feel that's a good thing. The town meeting, or the Board of Selectmen, suggested that from a perspective of supporting the town's wishes at 54% to address the recreational alcohol issue was really good. I think that the J.T. Berry was, a real plus and positive thing for the town, and the town came forward on that. I will admit I was a little disappointed on the situations surrounding the facilities at the turf field. I think it's important for everyone to understand that regardless, everyone's looking to do it for a cost-effective way. And I think that's important. Whether my amendment made it or not is less important to the issue of trying to find a more cost-effective way to save the town money. And I think we need to continue that way. And I also think that with the J.T. Berry issue that or success, we're going to have a lot of money coming into this town, relatively speaking. It's not a lot of money based on our needs, but it's a lot of money that we don't have right now. And I'm going to be fiscally very conservative on how we use that money, because I believe it needs to be used wisely, carefully, and not necessarily expeditiously. We need to make sure that these funds serve a purpose, and we must understand that the monies that came in were for economic development, and I think that's a very important aspect of that revenue. And if we want economic development, it's a very good chance that a good portion of that money, if not most of that money, needs to go towards anything that will
improve the town in its economic development. So, and just to go back to the bathrooms at the turf field, I know the inkling here is now to take the $450,000 and apply it to that structure. I have not been in support of that, and I think that that is money that was available for the town services that could have been used for town services as needed, and we could bond the bathrooms. That's one opinion of five. I understand that, but I think that we have some needs here at Town Hall that was money that was assigned to them, even though it was through salaries, but it was money that was assigned to the town, and it probably could have been used for good use within the town services that we have. Thank you.
Michael?
Yes, I as well want to thank the community for coming out. Over 200 people for a special town meeting. It was wonderful. I was so happy to see it, and it was a big evening for the town of North Reading. Regardless of some of the other subjects, it was very big for us to have a future now, have some money that this board will have to consider how we best fund that, what we do with those funds. And it's not just for EDC, Jeff. It's actually capital. And I think Mrs. Rourke got up there and did a good job explaining that the money from those proceeds can be used to go towards capital. And some of that capital can be used or invest in that could have a positive reflection for economic development. All good things. So we have some work to do, and that's one of the reasons why I want to thank the town administrator for capturing Article 26 and the warrant articles for us to consider, and we have some work to do. We have for the first time have an opportunity to actually make some changes here and put a plan in place that actually deals with this town hall and deals with this subject with the fire. I know this evening isn't the night to talk about it, but I'm very thankful to have that opportunity. And the J.T. Berry proceeds will help us have the ability to have that conversation. The other thing I was going to ask is there a reason why we don't have the strategic plan most updated on the town website? Did we not finish that process?
We didn't finish it. Remember?
Okay. What do we need to do to finish it? And is that, maybe is it me? Did I drop the ball?
Schedule a meeting.
We had the meeting.
So we continued it.
So the board did approve the objectives, which is what my concern was going into the FY18 budget process, and we presented those objectives at the department head meeting in November. You presented those, actually, Selectmen. But the rest of the plan, I believe, the board had deferred updating, and I think it's a matter of scheduling it, as I understand it.
Can we at least can we maybe just present or post the objectives?
I'm sure we could do that if the board.
I think we actually agreed on the progress assessments, and I think we agreed on the objectives. And if we want to delete the other slides until we can approve them, at least they'll be up there.
Mm-hmm. We could do that if there isn't any.
Yeah, I think so. Yeah. Probably a good idea.
Okay.
Anything else, Michael?
And you heard me talk to Mrs. Perney tonight about you're putting together an RFP on some of the one or two parcels for town land for a potential offering for senior housing. I think we should really seriously consider it. There's really nothing holding us back from it. We have everything to gain. We have nothing to lose. I'm not sure when the right time is to bring that up, but I would certainly like to see it on a future agenda, a near term. That's all I have.
I'm just going to ditto the thanking of those residents that came out to this town meeting. It's a very, very important town meeting, and we needed it for them, 150, and we got a couple hundred people, I think, initially, that came out for the meeting, and that was great. Michael, I want to thank you and the Economic Development Committee for your leadership in theirs and getting DeCamp to sign over the buried property to us and carrying it all the way to the point that we're well on our way to selling that property and yielding the benefits that come along with it. So I think the board should all be thanking you and committee for those efforts.
Thank you.
The board's been involved in it too, but I think that, you know, if you look at how we get things done, it's the initiative, individuals, volunteers, board members taking on particular challenges and getting those things done. So I just want to say thank you.
Thank you.
I was hoping to get back from everybody the TA reviews. I'm running out of time in terms of the goals I set for getting that done. I'm talking to you.
He's talking to me.
And me.
I didn't see anything from you, Mike.
Where's my star?
I've just been working a lot, almost every day.
Submitted a draft of the town, Board of Selectmen's town report.
Annual report.
To Karen, and Michael was going to take a look at it. And when I get it back with their comments, clean it up, I'll send it out to the board members. That's probably overdue at this point in time, or close to it.
No, thank you for sending it. I know she was looking at it today.
Yeah.
Thank you.
And I will not be at the next board meeting. I think I told everybody that. Hopefully, Catherine will be able to make it. I know we've had one meeting after another. It's got to the point where I think everybody's worn out. But we got a two-week break.
Unless
with
you're
a bunch of little meetings in between.
Yes, unless you're attending tomorrow's.
Who is that individual that's writing to you on emails questioning about the board meetings that were posted?
No, that was me.
What?
I questioned why they had, we had meetings tomorrow.
No, it had a funny name on it.
Yule?
I thought it was you.
No, it wasn't you. It was me. I don't know what he said.
Was it you?
I sent it to you and
I'm not a Jew, so.
It is a four-letter word.
I think he's just posting us for meetings in case a majority shows
right,
up.
Right, exactly.
That's correct, yes. Right. There's no mandate to attend.
Is that a board member that was
explained it, but
I actually,
the funny name.
The guy. I don't know whose email address he was using. Anyway.
But anyway, Mr. Chairman, I wish you the best of luck.
Yes.
Thank you. Thank you. Are we going to go back into executive session?
Yes,
I'll
Mr.
entertain
Chairman.
A motion. Go back into executive session. We'll take a five-minute break while.
So moved.
Do I hear a second?
Second.
Second by Mr. O'Leary. Mr. Prisco.
No.
Mr. Yule.
No. Yes.
Mr. O'Leary.
Aye.
The chair votes aye. Motion carries 3-1.
Sorry, I just got to get
Sorry,
early.
Michael.